The first item of business this afternoon is a statement by Michael Matheson on policing. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement, and there should therefore be no interventions or interruptions. I call Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary, 15 minutes.
Presiding Officer, I welcome this early opportunity to update Parliament on policing in Scotland. Our police officers and those who work to support them continue to do an excellent job in challenging circumstances, and I pay tribute to them again, all the men and women within Police Scotland who work day in, day out to protect our communities. Crime is at a 40-year low, with violent crime at its lowest level since 1974, and there is now more consistent access to specialist expertise and equipment across the country. And credit for this goes to the officers and staff across Police Scotland. Presiding Officer, we were all shocked and saddened by the terrible incident which claimed the lives of Lamara Bell and John Yule. Our thoughts continue to be with their families and friends. Police Scotland has publicly apologised, and on behalf of this government, I repeat my sympathies, and also I want to apologise to the families for the loss of their loved ones. We are truly sorry for what has happened. The PIRC is carrying out an independent investigation into the circumstances of the incident under the direction of the Crown, and this is a live and ongoing investigation. The remit of the HMICS review I instructed was to provide an accurate picture of the current capacity and capability within all control centres, both staff and systems, and the processes in place to ensure all calls are handled and dispatched appropriately. HMICS recommend the reform programme for the control centres is completed as planned. However, they make clear that this should only take place when the current control rooms in Govan and Bilston Glen have a full complement of trained staff, and when the systems and processes are capable of taking additional call demand from the north. When the new area control room in Dundee is fully operational, and after a detailed and independently assured transition plan is developed and delivered. HMICS recommends that centres in Dundee, Aberdeen and Inverness should remain open while this takes place. That is what will now happen. The remaining phase will only proceed once the SPA and HMICS are completely reassured that all these issues have been addressed. Police Scotland state that this recommendation will require the accelerated recruitment of 70 to 75 call handling staff to consolidate the service centre operations, plus additional area control room staff to ensure that the combined North Area Control Room in Dundee is fully operational before the closure of the Aberdeen and Inverness control rooms. It will also require to support the retention of staff in Aberdeen and Inverness for a period beyond the 31st of March 2016 to allow for an extensive handover operation. This will, of course, be subject to discussion with the unions and staff. There is a cost attached to implementing this recommendation, estimated by Police Scotland at around £1.4 million in this financial year. I can confirm to the Chamber today I'm making £1.4 million of new money available immediately for Police Scotland to meet this cost. The remaining phases of the change programme will be subject to regular and intensive scrutiny by both the SPA and HMICS. I've asked HMICS to ensure any further recommendations on the operation of call handling are shared as the review progresses to allow the SPA and Police Scotland to act as quickly as possible. Signing Officer, the M9 incident had terrible consequences. I don't want any family to have to go through that experience again. Signing Officer, we will also take early action on the issue of stop and search. In March, I asked eminent human rights QC John Scott to consider the legal framework around stop and search. His independent advisory group have now reported, and I've published that report today. We recommended a statutory code of practice to underpin how stop and search is used. We will implement their recommendations in full. I can therefore confirm that the current system of consensual stop and search will end once the code comes into effect. I've informed the convener of the Justice Committee that I intend lodging appropriate amendments to the Criminal Justice Bill at Stage 2 to give effect to this. There are two further areas where investigations are ongoing, and I wish to update Parliament of the progress of these investigations as much as I can. The PIRC investigation, under the direction of the Crown into the death of Sheikhu Bayu in police custody, is well advanced, and members will recognise that I am constrained in what I can say. However, my thoughts are with Mr Bayou's family at this terrible time. As the PIRC Commissioner emphasised earlier today, a number of expert forensic pathologists have been commissioned on the instruction of the Lord Advocate to further investigate and to provide an opinion on how Mr Bayou died. The Lord Advocate and the PIRC have met with the family and are committed to keeping them informed of the progress of their ongoing investigation. Media interest over the summer has also focused on reported breaches of the Code of Practice on the acquisition and disclosure of communication data, which came into force on the 25th of March this year. A final determination by the Interception of Communications Commissioner is awaited. IOCO has made clear it would be inappropriate for it to identify the forces under investigation while its investigation is ongoing, and has set out clear reasoning for this. In light of this ongoing investigation, it would not be appropriate for me to comment further, other than to say that ministers expect all public authorities in Scotland to comply with the Code of Practice on accessing communication data. The press must be able to operate freely with appropriate protections, and no individual should have their communication data inappropriately accessed. Policing reform in Scotland has gone through the most significant public sector reform in a generation. While there have been challenges, the creation of Police Scotland has allowed us to maintain officer numbers 1,000 higher than they were in 2007. Compare that to south of the border, where policing numbers were this week predicted to fall to their lowest level in 40 years. National units are ensuring a consistent approach to the most complex and time-consuming issues, such as serious and organised crime, rape and murder. Those hard-fought gains would not have been achieved without reform of policing in Scotland. In the programme for government on Tuesday, the First Minister set out the next steps this government will take to strengthen policing. And I want to provide Parliament with further detail on how these issues will be taken forward. Reform has increased scrutiny. Currently, 32 local scrutiny boards mean that there are now more councillors than ever before having a say on policing priorities in their area. And as Parliament will recall, to ensure the day-to-day operation of the police is entirely independent of government, Police Scotland is accountable to the SPA, which in turn is accountable to this government, with the Parliament's Justice Subcommittee providing regular and active challenge. There is independent oversight from HMICS and the PIRC, as well as from Audit Scotland. Police Scotland has faced greater levels of political, public and media scrutiny than ever before. But, Presiding Officer, I believe we can strengthen it further. The Chief Constable will therefore undertake a new programme of scrutiny sessions to provide more direct local accountability for the performance of policing in local areas. This will give local councils the opportunity to discuss policing in their area directly with the Chief Constable, senior officers and members of the SPA. I want to explore further with local conveners how this will work at the Local Scrutiny Summit that I'm holding on the 23rd of September. This will be an open dialogue, and I would welcome contributions from members across this chamber on how they think local scrutiny can be enhanced further. Signed Officer, the Scottish Government set the national priorities for policing prior to the implementation of police reform. We will now engage with stakeholders and communities on setting new national priorities for policing in Scotland. We will do so in partnership with a wide range of stakeholders with an interest in policing. This is an opportunity for people to tell us what they think the priorities should be in the future. Members will be aware that the Chief Constable announced last week that he would be stepping down. I would like to thank Sir Stephen House again for his service and contribution to policing in Scotland. He provided leadership at a crucial time with a strong focus on tackling violent crime, and he's made a major contribution to recorded crime falling to a 40-year low. Members will also be aware that the SPA Chair, Vic Emery, announced he would not be seeking reappointment when his 3-year term ends this month. Following an extensive recruitment process, I can confirm that Andrew Flanagan will become the new chair of the SPA, taking up post from Monday, the 7th of September. Andrew has served as a chief executive, chairman and non-executive director on a number of organisations. He brings an abundance of experience in challenging and high-profile posts in the public, private and the third sector, and I'm confident that Andrew will prove to be an excellent appointment. One of his key early priorities will be to appoint a suitable successor to Sir Stephen House, who can carry forward the process of reform to its conclusion and consolidate the delivery of its many benefits. The SPA has already started this process. I've already spoken to Andrew, and my immediate ask is that he undertake a review of police governance, supported by a reference group to contribute their views and suggestions. This will ensure accountability arrangements for policing can build on the lessons learned to date and ensure robust arrangements are in place for the future. Specifically, I've identified 4 areas that I want the Chair to focus upon. Ensuring local interests are effectively represented in the national scrutiny process. Ensuring the SPA has the appropriate structures and skills to undertake effective scrutiny. Ensure the SPA, HMICS and the Scottish Government and the Parliament have the material and data to require it to allow it to hold Police Scotland to account, and to review the way the authority works with other stakeholders to ensure its approach is rooted in partnership and contributes to wider objectives of our public sector in Scotland. I have today published the full remit of this review. What I've set out today is a significant and wide-ranging set of measures which will strengthen policing in Scotland. I know there have been challenges, and some of the events over the summer have prompted legitimate public concern. But the fundamentals of our policing remain sound. A skilled and committed workforce of officers and staff who deliver for our communities every day, and a process of reform to protect policing from the effects of austerity. The actions I'm announcing today will address the challenges and help us to learn from the initial years of reform. It will ensure policing in Scotland is effective, accountable and that it is community focused. I look forward to working with members to ensure we have the police service communities expect and deserve.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on issues raised in the statement. I intend to allow around 30 minutes for questions. after which we'll move on to the next item of business. If you wish to ask a question of the Minister, please press your request to speak button now. And I call Graeme Pearson. 2 minutes.
I'm obliged to presiding officer. I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for early sight of his statement. I welcome the tone in which it was delivered here today, and I join him in acknowledging a complete support from this side of the chamber for those officers and staff who deliver in policing across Scotland in the interests of our community. Today we have received, however, two weighty reports which reflect the significant problems at the heart of policing across Scotland, problems unseen and untouched by the SPA or this government until tragedy and controversy struck. Shortly after the Cabinet Secretary announced his call handling review, he said that there was nothing to suggest, and I quote, a systemic failure or the centre was overburdened. Given the damning contents of the HMIC review indicating the very opposite, can Mr Matheson tell Parliament on what basis both he and the Chief Constable were justified in pointing the finger at an unnamed officer accusing an individual failure? Scrutiny is about asking questions. Governance and accountability is about getting answers and justifications. In the light of these reports, will the Cabinet Secretary now commit to delivering what I asked for since arriving in Parliament, an independent system of rigorous governance and accountability with the aim of delivering the best police service in the world? Will he enable the incoming convener of the SPA, Mr Flanagan, to be appointed by this Parliament in that endeavour? Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, can I turn first of all, as Mr Pearson made reference to the two reports, he should be aware that the report in Stop and Search is a result of asking John Scott to undertake a review of Stop and Search in Scotland back in March, not in the summer. It was back in March that that report was commissioned and the independent advisory group was established. Can I also return to the issue he made about the point he made regarding the M9 incident? Of course, at the time following that incident, in the discussions I had with the Chief Constable, they had looked at what had happened in that particular instance, and I was making my comments based upon the advice that had been provided by Police Scotland. But as the member will recognise, I instructed HMICS to undertake a review to address capacity, capability and process in order to be assured as to whether there were any systemic failings in the system. That's why I set up HMICS's review on that basis, because I wanted that assurance that we can ensure that nothing like this ever happens again. Now, I welcome what we have got from the HMICS report so far as a way in which we can start to address some of these issues. And once we have the final report later in October, we'll be able to then look at what further measures may be necessary. But I'm sure no one is in any doubt, having considered the range of issues that HMICS have already considered, that this is anything other than a very thorough and independent investigation into all call handling within Police Scotland. And can I turn to the issue that Mr Pearson has raised again, and that is the issue about scrutiny and accountability and how the national process fits into the local process. It's an issue which the member raised with me back in June this year when I was before the policing subcommittee in Parliament. And I've already stated I believe there is a need to make sure that that local accountability ties into the national process. As I set out, the governance review will actually have a responsibility in looking at how we can achieve that much more effectively. I am determined to make sure that the way in which we make sure that Police Scotland is accountable is that there is very strong local community input into shaping how policing is provided within local communities. And with the National Review and the Scrutiny Summit, I believe we can achieve that much more effectively, and in doing so, make sure that policing is delivered within local communities in a way that local people want it to see being delivered.
Margaret Mitchell.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for early sight of his statement. with an extra £1.4 million now having to be allocated to the recruitment of support staff, it was clearly a false economy to make so many crucial support staff redundant in the first place. These individuals are absolutely essential to the smooth running of our police force and in ensuring calls are handled properly in an effort to keep our streets safe and protect the public. Given the vexing problems associated with the centralised 101 call system, it's astounding that the HMIC's interim report makes the recommendation that the reform programme for control centres should be completed as planned, especially given the concerns and complaints from rank-and-file officers about its operation and also about the target-led approach to stop and search. Will the Cabinet Secretary therefore confirm today, as part of the governance review, that establishing a system of meaningful dialogue with rank-and-file officers is included in the SPA remit, and that the Scottish Government, who has now been in charge of policing for 8 years, ensures this is delivered?
Cabinet Secretary.
Just to try and help to make some progress on this issue, the SPA do engage with staff and union associations on a regular basis in order to discuss issues of mutual interest and concern with them. Now, I've got no doubt that there are ways in which they can improve that dialogue, but as the member will be aware, of the four key areas that I have asked the new incoming chair of the SPA to consider as part of that national review, part of that is about how they engage with stakeholders and the contribution that they could make. So I would hope, given the remit that I've now issued for the new incoming chair to take forward as part of that national review, she'd be reassured that that's what it will assist us in doing, making sure there's effective dialogue with the range of stakeholders on how the governance process of policing is taken forward in Scotland.
Christine Graham, followed by Alison McInnes.
Oh, thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I refer the Cabinet Secretary to the Recommendation 6 of John Scott's review group and say I welcome the suggestion that the Scottish Government may legislate for statutory authority to search 18-year-olds and under if they've got suspicions of alcohol. But this is my question. What if a child is suspected of carrying, say, drugs or a knife, either for their own use or drugs for sale or because someone has secreted those about them? Consent would not be appropriate and there may be urgency. Will the proposed statutory code of guidance deal with what is actually a welfare issue?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signed Officer, in the report itself, the advisory group identify potentially the searching of under-18s for alcohol as an area where there may be a legislative gap. However, the advisory group are not persuaded that that is the case, but they believe that we should have a consultation in order to consider this issue further. They also considered the issue around welfare matters for children, and they were not persuaded that there was a need to make any specific provision for that with a legislative change, because they believe there is existing legislation to deal with that. But as I said, we are taking forward all of the recommendations, and that means that we will also have the consultation into the statutory code of practice so that all parties will have an opportunity to scrutinise it and to comment on what the content of that statutory code should be. Following that process, it will then be my responsibility, Presiding Officer, to bring that before Parliament. And I have got no doubt, as is often the case with Ms Graham's committee, they will be vigorous and very thorough in considering that matter as to whether it deals with all of the issues in that she has raised effectively. But I'm confident going through with the consultation exercise, we can address any other issues that may arise before we actually finalise the code of practice.
Alison McInnes, followed by Roderick Campbell.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement and indeed John Scott at QC for his thoughtful report. For 2 years, SNP ministers insisted they were comfortable with consensual stop and search and refused our appeals to intervene. Meanwhile, Police Scotland conducted 1 million unlawful searches and young and vulnerable people were targeted. In February, I tabled amendments to the Criminal Justice Bill that would abolish consensual stop and search. Will the Justice Secretary now undertake to work with me to end this utterly discredited practice? But I want to press the Cabinet Secretary to go further. In setting up the single police force, the government set off a chain reaction that continues to build. Stop and search is just one indication of the top-down, target-driven culture that exists in Police Scotland. Will the Cabinet Secretary therefore go further and instruct an independent review of Police Scotland's management and culture?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, we have already instructed a review of the governance processes within Police Scotland, as was set out by the First Minister on Tuesday in the programme for government, and I have given further details of that today, alongside the other work that we are going to take forward in looking at building in further improvements around scrutiny as well. When the Member makes reference to the top-down culture in targets, she will also appreciate that there is a level of, well, there is operational independence from ministers in setting particular targets for the police. Now, I have got no doubt that an incoming Chief Constable will choose to consider what they believe is the most appropriate way forward in setting any targets or the culture which they set in the organisation. And I have got no doubt that the SPA will want to engage with them on that matter. Turning to the other point which the Member made reference to, and that is around stop and search as well. And I do recognise her long-standing interest in pursuing this particular matter. It is worth noting that the level of stop and search under Police Scotland over the last couple of years has been dropping dramatically. It has dropped by some 40%. Can I also point out the figures out today have actually shown that for June, 69% of searches were statutory and 31% were consensual. That's almost exactly a reversal of the 2014 percentage. So there has been significant changes already taking place. But as I set out, we now believe there should be a statutory code of practice setting out the powers of the police around this matter. And once the consultation has been taken forward and we have finalised that code of practice, we will then implement what will be the ending of consensual stop and search. And I am, of course, more than happy to work with the Member on the amendments that she has already laid before the Criminal Justice Bill to consider whether they are appropriate or whether they need to be adapted in order to fulfil the objective of making sure that we put the statutory code of practice into the Criminal Justice Bill.
Roderick Campbell, followed by Claire Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given matters as they stand now, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with Callum Steele of the Scottish Police Federation that if anyone wants to see what a real crisis in policing is, they need only to cast their eyes to our friends in England and Wales, where police numbers are set to fall to levels not seen since the 1970s?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, there's absolutely no doubt that reforming policing in Scotland was an essential requirement in order to make sure that we could protect our policing numbers. We have continued to make sure that we have 1,000 more police officers than we inherited back in 2007. And we had to make sure that the structural reform that we delivered would assist us in maintaining those police numbers. But it's also very clear from other parts of the UK that because of their failure to address some of the very significant inefficiencies within police services, that they are now facing very significant cuts in police numbers. For example, in England, they've almost lost 17,000 police officers already since 2009. And it's been predicted that there will possibly be another 20 to 22,000 police officers lost over the coming years. So I am absolutely clear about the benefits of police reform in making sure that we can release resource in order to help maintain our police numbers. And as a government, we will continue to move forward with police reform to ensure we have the most efficient and the most effective police service we can have in Scotland.
Claire Baker, followed by John Mason.
Presiding Officer, I have been supporting the family of Sheikh Ubayu, who died in police custody this year. It is unacceptable that it took more than a month for police officers to provide evidence to Park. This delay appears to have been caused by a memo which was issued by Police Service of Scotland, which advised officers not to give evidence. This was a grave error. Will the review into police governance include looking at how deaths in custody are responded to by Police Scotland, and also will examine the extent of Park's powers to deal with these types of cases?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm not sure whether the Member is already aware that HMICS have already looked into the way in which Police Scotland deal with individuals in custody. And the report was issued last year, which showed that there have been significant improvements in the way in which Police Scotland handle individuals in custody.
Order.
And deal with and deal with these particular matters. But given that this is a live investigation, I think it's most appropriate to allow both the PIRC and the Crown Office to undertake that investigation in a thorough and detailed way, as the Lord Advocate and the PIRC have already set out. Once that process has been completed, it would be appropriate to then consider whether any further measures are required. But over the summer, I've already had a discussion with the Commissioner at PIRC to consider whether they do have any concerns about the powers that they have at the present time for undertaking those investigations. And the view of the Commissioner at this present stage is that they believe that their powers are adequate for the purposes of undertaking these investigations, but they clearly keep these matters under review. If at any point, as I've said in the past, there is an indication that the powers which the PIRC have are not adequate enough in order to undertake these investigations appropriately, then we as a government will act. But I think it's most appropriate that we allow both the PIRC and the Crown Office to complete this investigation, and once that has been completed, to consider whether there's any further measures that will then be necessary.
John Mason, followed by Elaine Murray.
Thank you. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking on board some recent very serious and tragic issues. But I wonder if he agrees with me that the overall picture on policing is very positive. Violent crime is at its lowest since 1974, and we need to keep the present problems in perspective.
Cabinet Secretary.
Signed Officer, as I stated in my statement, the fundamentals of policing in Scotland are very strong, and we intend to make sure that we continue to build upon them. As I also outlined, crime is at a 40-year low. Particular areas such as violent crime are at their lowest levels. But there is clearly more that we need to do in making sure that we continue to make progress in tackling crime within our society. And I've got no doubt that as we move forward, that Police Scotland will continue to make a very significant and positive contribution to reducing crime within communities across Scotland.
Elaine Murray, followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary has accepted the recommendation in the interim HMICS report to suspend the planned closures of the control rooms in Aberdeen, Inverness and Dundee. So does the Cabinet Secretary regret that Police Scotland, the Scottish Police Authority and his predecessor refused to listen to the concerns expressed by control centre staff, police officers and elected representatives in Dumfries and Galloway prior to the closure of the Dumfries control room in May last year? And does he accept that had the warnings given by experienced police officers and staff been heeded, some of the subsequent problems with centralised call handling might have been avoided?
Cabinet Secretary.
My focus is on moving forward on this particular issue and making sure that the issues that are identified by HMIC are appropriately addressed and that they are addressed quickly. It's important. The experience that we had with the M9 incident is never allowed to happen again, and it's important we make sure that all of the systems and processes they have in place are there to minimise the risk of that. That's why we're providing the additional £1.4 million to Police Scotland as new money in order to allow them to take this forward as quickly as possible. And that's why I've also asked HMICS to make sure that any issues which they identify over the course of their investigation in the next 6 to 8 weeks, that where they identify them, they flag them up to both the SPA and Police Scotland to ensure that they can be addressed quickly and effectively. And I will continue to engage with HMICS to make sure that appropriate actions are being taken where they have been identified.
Kevin Stewart, followed by John Finney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Audit Scotland and HMIC were fairly critical of police boards and the poor level of scrutiny and governance in the past. And we're probably seeing a greater degree of scrutiny and accountability than ever before. Can the Cabinet Secretary say more about the scrutiny and accountability that Police Scotland will face in the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I think it would be any fair-minded person would recognise that Police Scotland is under more scrutiny than any other police force that we had previously under the eight legacy forces. That's not just my view. That's the view of the chair of the Scottish Police Federation, who has made that very clear. But can I say that I believe that we can enhance on it yet further? And as I've mentioned, there's the issue of the Chief Constable meeting on a regular basis, several times a year, with scrutiny board chairpersons to be questioned on local policing matters. And what I want to do at the scrutiny summit, which I announced back in June of this year when I was at the policing subcommittee before this parliament, is to look at how we can build on that and to make sure that the good practice that goes on in some of our local policing scrutiny committees is rolled out to those other policing scrutiny committees in other parts of the country. And I want to hear the views of those within the scrutiny panels to consider what they think could assist them in undertaking that enhanced scrutiny. And I've got no doubt that members across this chamber will want to express their view on how they believe scrutiny can be further enhanced. But I think, Presiding Officer, the important thing to recognise is that the level of scrutiny we now have in policing in Scotland is greater than ever before. But I do believe that we can build on that and make it better. And in doing so, making sure that we have a much more transparent and accountable police force in Scotland, one which the people of Scotland can have faith and trust in.
John Finney, followed by Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary John Scott's an eminent QC, and his report says, and I quote, in relation to stop and search, there's a lack of legal framework, questionable lawfulness and legitimacy. Would you acknowledge that many people would be astonished that in response to that you have said, and notwithstanding the government's legislative programme, you have said, I can therefore confirm the current system of consensual stop and search will end once that code comes into effect. Many people would have anticipated that you would have been calling on no stop and search to take place that doesn't have a basis in common law or statutory law. Would you appreciate that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as a member will be aware, Police Scotland are presently operating on the basis that they have a presumption against consensual stop and search and that they are no longer undertaking any consensual stop and searches of those under 12, which is reflected in the figures that I just mentioned that were published here today. But I am taking forward the approach that has been outlined by the Independent Advisory Group. They are the Independent Advisory Group who are recommending that we have a consultation on their draft code of conduct and that we should then have a phased introduction as a changeover to how stop and search is undertaken. I think the best thing for us to do is to listen to that advice and to take it forward. And that's why I'm going to move quickly in making sure that we have an amendment within the Criminal Justice Bill that will give effect to the statutory code of conduct, and once that's been completed through the consultation process, to then have that implemented. But I think we should listen to the Independent Advisory Group who say that we should take this forward in stages, which involves training and information for officers on the change of approach that will come about as a result of that. And in doing that, we can make sure that we get the balance right between the rights of individuals and the rights of the police to be able to pursue legitimate issues as well. And I believe that the Independent Advisory Group strikes that balance.
Lewis MacDonald, followed by Christian Allard.
Does the Cabinet Secretary acknowledge that the 101 Service Centre in Aberdeen led the way, not just in Scotland, but in policing across the UK in pioneering modern call handling technology? Does he regret the damage done to the quality of that service as it has been run down over the last 18 months, as described in today's interim report? And will he not now act to restore a high-quality public service by scrapping these closure plans altogether?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I've mentioned, because the member's almost inviting me not to go with the recommendation of HMICS here, and that is that the end model of the changeover of the contact and control centres should continue, and progress should continue to be maintained in pursuing that. What we should do in the intervening period is to consolidate and to make sure that we have sufficient resilience in the other contact and control centres that we have in place at the present moment. What I intend to do is to make sure that there's sufficient financial resource to allow them to continue with the provision of service that they have at the contact centre in Aberdeen, at Dundee and also in Inverness. So I'm going to go with the recommendation that's been set out by HMICS rather than take an approach which would be the members' view, is that we should take a different route altogether. I think, given the nature of their expertise in this matter, I'm much more inclined to go with HMICS than Lewis MacDonald's.
Christian Allard, followed by Margaret MacDougall.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his statement, and I agree the fundamentals of our policing remain sound. So does the new structure. On accountability, would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that chief constables have stepped down in the past before the creation of Police Scotland? And the solution is not to change the structure as proven south of the border by the Police and Crime Commissioner for South Yorkshire, who resigned from the Labour Party but refused to stand down from office.
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, I believe that the overall... I believe the overall architecture we have from the police and fire reform legislation is the right architecture for taking forward our police and fire service into the future. What I do believe we can do is we can strengthen elements of it, particularly around scrutiny and accountability. And the measures that I set out here this afternoon, along with what the First Minister set out in the programme for government, will assist us in achieving that. Now that we have our new chair of the SPA in place, the process of recruiting a replacement for Sir Stephen House will move forward. As that process moves forward and we then appoint a new chief constable, I've got no doubt they will want to reflect on the present standing of Police Scotland to consider whether they want to take a different approach in different areas. But what I'm determined to make sure happens is that there is a very good level of local engagement in the decision-making process around how Police Scotland moves forward. And that's something that I've asked the chair of the SPA, the new chair of the SPA, to take forward as part of the wider governance review. And I would expect that also to be reflected in the new national standards that we set for policing in Scotland, which will then provide the new chief constable with a clear sense of direction and what we expect to see delivered from policing going forward.
Margaret McDougall, followed by Neil Findlay.
Thank you. I note you say the Chief Constable will undertake a new programme of scrutiny sessions. What training will be given to local councillors who already have a very heavy workload to ensure they properly interrogate the Chief Constable and the SPA Board so that they are held to account? And also, is the membership of the SPA Board going to be reviewed given they failed to meet during the summer when there was clearly a crisis within Police Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
I don't know whether the member missed the point I was making about having the scrutiny summit later this month, because the very purpose of that is to bring together the conveners of the scrutiny boards to consider how we can make sure those policing scrutiny boards that are working very effectively and are doing a good job, actually we can spread that practice to other parts of the country as well. And that's to engage with them to hear exactly what they think is necessary in order to support and assist in achieving that. Now, if some of them need some form of training, of course, we'll look at that. But what I do think is important here is to make sure that the quality of that engagement translates into action in the way in which the SPA and Police Scotland respond to that. And that's what I'm determined to make sure that we see a step change in being taken forward in the way in which the governance process of Police Scotland and the SPA is taken forward.
Neil Findlay.
In relation to scrutiny and practice, does the Cabinet Secretary share my concern that Police Scotland will neither confirm nor deny that they are monitoring the activities of environmental trade union and political activists and whether that information is being provided to third parties? And will the Cabinet Secretary, in government time, bring a debate on policing to the Chamber so that we can discuss all of these issues relating to the state of Police Scotland? And finally, will he join me in condemning John Mason's grossly insensitive comments about keeping perspective? Mr Mason, people have died.
Mr Findlay.
People have died. You should be ashamed of your comments.
Mr Findlay, you're asking questions on the statement, not on the comments of others, Cabinet Secretary.
Dealing with the two substantive points that, Mr Findlay raised, on the first point in itself, I've got no knowledge of Police Scotland having certain individuals under surveillance in this matter. And if the member has an issue of concern about that, it's an issue which he could obviously pursue with Police Scotland. If he's dissatisfied with that, he could take it up with IOCO, who would be able to look at this matter, or the Surveillance Commissioner themselves. And in relation to having a debate on these issues and wider issues, I should point out to the member that a 17-minute speech on Tuesday, the leader of our party made absolutely no mention of policing whatsoever. And in the closing speech yesterday, Ian Gray made absolutely no mention of policing as well. Not one single point did they raise about policing. And, given that the Labour Party have got business next
week, stop the heckling.
If they wish to have a debate on policing, they are obviously free to be able to bring it forward in their debate next week.
That ends the statement on policing from the Cabinet Secretary. Point of order, Alison McKinnon.
Thank you very much. Presiding Officer, the ministerial statement we've just heard covered eight distinct and important areas of concern about Police Scotland. I welcome the statement and the fact that time was extended to allow as many members as possible to ask questions. Nevertheless, our Parliament cannot possibly do justice to the matters outlined in such a constrained format. Since Police Scotland was set up, the Government has never once used its debating time to discuss or review the impacts of reform. And I think it is perhaps pertinent today to reflect on that. Presiding Officer, can I ask you to ensure that the Government Business Manager has every opportunity to bring forward, as soon as possible, a debate in Government time on the important matters that the Cabinet Secretary has raised today?
Can I thank the Member for the advance notice of this point of order? As the Member is aware, the business programme is not for the Presiding Officer to determine. It is a matter for the Bureau to recommend the business programme, and I would suggest that she, as a business manager, raises it directly in the Bureau. We now move to the next item of business, which is a statement by Fergus Ewing on the Scottish Government's response to the planned closure of Longannet Power Station. I'll give a few moments for members to change seats. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement. There should therefore be no interventions or interruptions. Can I call on Fergus Ewing, Minister? 10 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This statement concerns the economic consequences of the planned closure of Longannet Power Station in 2016 and the response of the Scottish Government, of our agencies and partners. We need to acknowledge, of course, that Longannet remains open and will continue to operate over the coming winter. Highly skilled staff and contractors will stay in place to produce much-needed power over the winter months when electricity demand is highest. While spare capacity across the UK, Presiding Officer, remains perilously low, Longannet plays an essential role in keeping lights on across these islands. Just over a fortnight ago, on the 18th of August, Scottish Power confirmed that Longannet would close on the 31st of March next year, ending 46 years of power production at the Fife station. Facing high transmission charges and rising cost of carbon, Scottish Power has concluded that electricity production at Longannet is no longer commercially viable. For the same reasons, the company has also decided not to progress development of the planned 1,000 megawatt gas-fired generating station at Cockenzie in East Lothian, which was consented in 2011. These announcements are deeply regrettable. They reflect very badly on a system of transmission charges introduced to Scotland in 2005 by a Labour government, which makes it increasingly difficult to operate existing thermal plant in Scotland or invest in cleaner replacements. The outcome of UK energy policy and regulation is totally irrational when new cleaner thermal capacity is the very thing needed to safeguard our energy security. Despite the huge scale and range of Scotland's energy resources, energy policy remains largely a reserve matter, and the Scotland Bill will not radically shift the status quo. So we must suffer the effects of policies devised in Westminster that undermine our own energy objectives to maintain a balanced, low-carbon energy mix based on renewables, flexible thermal generation, fitted with CCS and greater energy storage. Despite raising our concerns repeatedly, Presiding Officer, with the Prime Minister, absolutely nothing has changed. Before I outline our response to planned closure, I want to underline the huge significance of Longannet. Longannet is the largest power station in Scotland, the second largest in the UK, with capacity to power 2 million homes. The station directly employs 236 people in high-skilled work and sustains a large and valuable supply chain with hundreds of associated jobs in the coal, transport and service sectors. We know, for example, that around half of the coal produced in Scotland in 2014 was destined for Longannet. Presiding Officer, it's against this background that I turn now to the response of the Scottish Government, our agencies and partners. As concerns over the station's future increased earlier in the year, both I and the Deputy First Minister visited Longannet to meet with company and staff representatives. I also met with the Leader and Deputy Leader of Fife Council in March, and without preempting Scottish Power's decision, we agreed to develop a joint response in the event of closure. On the 25th of March, I made a parliamentary statement following news Longannet had lost out on National Grid's voltage control contract. Since then, I've had two formal meetings with Scottish Power, Fife Council and workforce representatives to assess the situation and consider ways to secure the best possible outcomes for all of those affected. Those meetings in May and June set the foundation to build a collegiate and coordinated response. Our initiative for responding to redundancy situations, PACE, that's Partnership Action for Continuing Employment, has offered immediate support for directly affected employees. PACE will continue to work closely with the company and workforce representatives to provide a tailored package of support. That support extends to any employees indirectly affected, for example, in supply chain companies. By providing skills development and employability support, PACE aims to minimise the time people affected by redundancy are out of work. Our statistics show, Presiding Officer, that 72%, nearly three quarters of those who received PACE support, obtain employment within 6 months. We have also established a new task force to develop a joint multi-agency action plan to mitigate the impacts of the closure locally and across the supply chain. The Longannet Task Force, which I co-chair with David Ross, the leader of Fife Council, comprises elected parliamentary representatives, local authorities, trade unions, businesses and government agencies, including Scottish Enterprise and Skills Development Scotland. At our first meeting on the 24th of August, we agreed our focus and committed to produce an economic recovery plan that will support workers to find new jobs, mitigate the effects on the supply chain, produce a master plan for the long-term future of the Longannet site, and consider how best to create sustainable employment in the local area. Secondly, on Monday this week, the 31st of August, I hosted a supply chain event in Dunfermline to hear directly from a cross-section of businesses about the expected impact upon them and their staff of the closure. I listened to businesses from across Scotland that face losing substantial income, including small family-run businesses concerned for their very survival. The event outlined the range of support available from the public sector for skills, training and business development. Our agencies are committed to working closely with affected businesses to help them through this worrying time and to support people who could be facing redundancy. This is a process of ongoing engagement with the business community, and our economic recovery plan will be informed by the needs of business. The coal sector, which is already challenged by low coal prices and reducing demand, will feel the effects of Longannet's closure especially hard. The Scottish coal industry has put forward proposals to the UK Government for restoration coal. This initiative would introduce a carbon price support exemption for legacy open cast coal sites to incentivise the restoration of those sites and, in turn, bring the land back into use. This has the potential to mitigate the job impacts on the coal sector of the Longannet closure and help to sustain activity. The UK Government committed to discuss restoration options for open cast coal sites with the Scottish Coal Task Force in the Chancellor's 2015 budget statement. Following that, I have written to the UK Government on three occasions to accelerate discussions. As a result of this, UK Government officials agreed to meet key industry players and Scottish Coal Task Force officials last Friday, the 27th of August. The exemption proposal was discussed at length during this meeting, and the Coal Task Force is now awaiting the UK Government's formal response. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I have outlined a series of initial actions the Scottish Government, our agencies and partners are taking to mitigate the effects of Longannet's closure. Well before Scottish Power's closure announcement, discussions had begun behind the scenes. We fought hard to achieve a different outcome for Longannet, whilst the UK Government refused to lift a finger. We engaged the Prime Minister and National Grid, principally on the grounds of Longannet's unique contribution to Scotland's energy security and resilience. Longannet's power is needed for the coming winter, and the station could, under the right circumstances, have operated successfully until at least the turn of the decade. Now that that closure has been announced, I can assure the Chamber that the Scottish Government will continue to do all we can to secure the best outcome possible from this disappointing situation. That is our duty, Presiding Officer, to the employees affected, to their families, to the main supply chain companies impacted, and to the immediate and surrounding communities of the Longannet plant.
Thank you. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak button now. Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I first of all thank the Minister for advance notice of his statement? The announcement was a shock and a body blow to all the workers in Longannet, to local communities in Fife and to businesses across Fife and central Scotland. Can I ask the Minister, did he ask Scottish Power, a global energy player, for a delay in the closure programme to enable all possible options to be explored? My understanding is that the transmission charges gap has been closing, and this was something which we would certainly have supported being looked at. Given that 50% of Scottish coal goes to Longannet, there aren't just the jobs at Longannet under threat, but in the supply and freight chains right across Scotland. And given the widespread concerns the Minister has referred to about restoration, what is the current position on those sites which were already challenging, and how will the closure of Longannet impact on delivering the restoration projects we urgently need across the country? The announcement cuts across efforts to achieve a just transition to meet our energy needs. Colleagues representing local communities will clearly have detailed questions about the investment the Scottish Government will put into a future to all those affected. But given that this week's programme for government highlighted the importance of thermal generation to Scotland's electricity mix and the importance of carbon capture and storage for our energy mix going forward, will the Minister now review the Scottish Government's energy strategy to ensure we have a bridge to the future and that the jobs and the experience of those affected by the early closure of Longannet across the whole supply chain are not lost?
Minister.
Well, I'll endeavour to answer as many of the questions I can from the member. First of all, of course, we urge Scottish Power to do everything possible to keep the station open. And we did so over a long period. We did so at a number of meetings, including ones at Longannet itself. I have to point out to the member that it was, in fact, the Labour government in 2005 that introduced this system of charging. And this system of charging now, and it's a matter of fact that I don't think is really disputed, Presiding Officer, means that, as the company explained, the additional charges which they had to pay in transmission for access to the grid were of the order of £40 million a year now, as opposed to what they would pay were they located, say, in Kent. In other words, the Scottish surcharge was £40 million. And that followed from the system that the Labour government did introduce. Now, the member did say, I believe the gap was narrowing, and I think I can attribute this particular line of argument to a certain Brian Wilson, who wrote a piece in The Scotsman, which I did find somewhat on the splenetic side for my liking. But sadly for him, the facts were clearly set out in a response to that article by Keith Anderson, who is the Chief Executive of Scottish Power, is in a better position, I think, to set out the facts in this matter. And far from the gap narrowing, Mr. Anderson says, and I quote from his letter, which I believe was carried in the Scotsman, it would become not 40 million, but 50 million in 2017. So the facts were wrong in Mr. Wilson's argument. And sadly, we have the situation where the surcharge, the Scottish surcharge, means that as many expert commentators from whom I can readily quote, presiding officer, that it is commercially not viable to either set up a new thermal plant in Scotland at the moment because of the Westminster penalty, nor continue to operate Scottish existing thermal plants, as I'm happy to explain to other members in the course of this session.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, presiding officer. Can I thank the minister for an advance copy of his statement and for the invitation to join the task force, the establishment of which we welcome. The reasons for the early closure of Longannet have been much debated over recent weeks. The minister focused on the transmission charging issue while glossing over a range of other matters, not least this government's obsession with wind power. He does not mention that the SNP's preferred alternative to the current transmission charging regime would, according to Ofgem, add a staggering £8 billion to consumer bills. £8 billion hitting hardest in Scotland, where fuel poverty is already too high. Presiding officer, as a representative for Fife, I want the priority now to be what can be done to help the workforce and retain skills. There are opportunities to create jobs in the area from developing underground coal gasification, but the licence holder, Clough Natural Resources, announced 2 weeks ago that they would be putting their development plans on hold, citing political uncertainty. Should the minister not be trying to attract investors to Fife rather than scaring them away?
Minister.
Well, I think the problem about attracting investment of new power stations is clearly set out by a commentator on BBC Radio Scotland news arrival on the 17th of February, referring to the current transmission charging system. He said, these charges, it does discriminate against Longannet, and that's a matter of concern for me. The commentator, of course, was one Murdo Fraser, MSP. He was actually joined by Alex Johnson, who's not here, but who said, I support the Scottish Government's argument that a more favourable charging regime would be welcome, and I hope that it will come forward. Well, it hasn't. And finally, just to complete a trio here, Mr. Brian Wilson again, said Ofgem's decision on locational charging is just one part of the jigsaw, but it sends a clear signal. Their view is that generation should take place close to the markets, preferably south of the Wash. Not an argument that he rehearsed recently, presiding officer. Could I also say, with regard to the £8 billion argument that Murdo Fraser alluded to here, first of all, I have to correct him, because the witness that gave evidence to the EET committee did not refer to £8 billion, but to £7 billion. But then again, you know, what's a billion between such commentators? The difficulty about that argument is that it's entirely wrong, because experts have subsequently confirmed that rather than the £7 billion referring to extra costs for the Scottish consumer, they were largely based up on wholesale costs attributable to the whole of the UK. So that figure is completely useless. Could I also say, presiding officer, in conclusion, that the stark fact is that in Scotland we have 13% of the electricity generation, and we have 42% of the transmission charges. Imagine if income tax in the UK was set at different rates, 13% in England and 42% in Scotland. I think were that the case, and that's an exact parallel to the additional tariff facing this company, that, imagine if that were the case, I think we would see that Mr. Fraser and his colleagues would be the first to condemn it.
Alex Salmon, followed by Willie Rennie.
Is it not the case that if we could move Longannet to central London, instead of paying the penalty of £40 million in transmission charges, it would receive a subsidy of £11 million? And after 10 years of campaigning against charges introduced by Brian Wilson as the Energy Minister of a Labour government, pursued by a Conservative and Liberal administration, and now by a Conservative administration, we've received some slight modification of the charges. but nothing like what is required to eliminate this clear discrimination against Scottish electricity generation. If France, Germany, Belgium and the Netherlands can pursue an electricity policy without such discrimination, why can't we unleash the natural resources of Scotland to help us produce the most competitive electricity in these islands? And isn't it time, instead of parroting nonsense from Ofgem, we had control of that organisation in this Parliament?
Minister.
Well, I must say it's a new pleasure to be able to entirely agree with the former First Minister from the front benches, Presiding Officer. But I think, to be serious, if anyone is entitled to advance these arguments, it is Alex Salmond, because he has been campaigning for a fair deal for Scotland, not just over the past year on this, but indeed since the charges were introduced by the Labour government. And so he's entirely right that we have a system of transmission charge apartheid in the UK, where Scotland is on the receiving end of extra charges, and where, whilst Murdo Fraser is smirking and grinning and laughing now, on the radio he admitted with his colleague Alex Johnson that that is exactly the problem. But let me quote independent experts who are out with the political terrain, presiding officer, Stuart Hazeldean, University of Edinburgh. At the moment, the transmission charging regime militates against the rebuilding of thermal power plant in Scotland. Very simple, not complicated. Professor Karen Turner says, and I quote, and this was evidence actually Mr Fraser may recall because it was given to him in the EET committee, perhaps he's forgotten it, let me remind him. The main obstacle is the network pricing, where generators are charged based on their distance from the population centres that they serve. There could be an argument that based on that policy, no power stations will be built above the Watford gap.
Will there any followed by Cara Hilt?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Minister for an advance sight of his statement? As the former MP for Longannet, I worked long and hard to try and get new investment into the plant to extend its life and to make it greener. So I'm disappointed by the decision, including on carbon capture and storage, which effectively ended its life. I'm sure the Minister will agree with me about the UK Government's onshore wind policy. And I think it's very damaging. I hope he agrees with me on that. So has he considered the policy exchanges proposal published just last week called Powering Up, which sets out a considerable opportunity for onshore wind in Scotland? Considering their associations with the Conservative Party, I hope he might look at this area of policy, because I think we need to put inordinate pressure on the UK Government to change its views.
Minister.
Well, we are putting inordinate pressure on the UK Government to change its views. We will continue to do that. I'm looking forward to meeting Amber Rudd on the 21st of this month, Presiding Officer. I haven't seen the particular article, but of course we believe that it is correct to have high ambitions for renewable energy in Scotland, not least because we're the best place in the UK and arguably in Europe to generate electricity from the power of the elements. I mean, that is the case for Scotland being the green powerhouse of the UK. And that is a role which we have been providing, exporting electricity to England on 98% of the time between the years from 2012 to 2015. And that is because the power of the wind. And last year, of course, 49.8% of our electricity came from renewable sources. We do believe, of course, that in the light of changed circumstances and facts and the abrupt withdrawal of support for onshore wind by the UK government, that we have to review matters to reflect the changing facts. It is a matter of total fiscal perversity that the UK government should pull the rug from the least expensive method of generating renewable electricity, given that the CFD is £80 for onshore wind, £114 cheapest for offshore wind. That means, according to my maths, the cost will be 34 over 80 more than it should be. Or, to put it more clearly, as Keith Anderson said, consumers will pay £2,000 to £3,000 million extra on their electricity bills because of the muddle-headed, perverse and irrational policies pursued by Mr Fraser's London bosses.
Can I say I now have 9 members who wish to ask a question, so can I ask that the questions and the answers are brief? Cara Hilton, followed by Rod Camp.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a constituency member for Longannet, the closure announcement is obviously a devastating blow for the communities I represent and for the workers and for their families. I'm pleased that the Minister acted within days of Scottish Power's announcement to set up the task force and was pleased to be asked to be a member of the task force too. But given that the Scottish Government have long anticipated the closure of Longannet by 2020, regardless of the transmission charging issue, for example in the Scottish Government's Climate Change Action Plan and the Scottish Government report on proposals and policies, why has there been no clear strategy to secure inwards investment to Kincardine and Fife to manage the inevitable transition for the communities and workers? We're now looking at 1,000 job losses in Fife and across central Scotland as a result, and that's alongside the job losses at Tullis Russell and Havelock Europa announced this week. Given the significant investment made available when the halls of Broxburn closed, what money will the Scottish Government make available to the Longannet Task Force for regeneration activities?
Minister.
Well, first of all, I was pleased that we pursue the bipartisan approach in the task force. I think that's right. I think members will appreciate that we always seek to conduct these meetings as we did in the case of the Longannet task force, which met on the 24th of August, in a way which eschews kind of partisan politics and gets on with the job in hand. I would welcome the fact that both Cara Hilton and Douglas Chapman MP attended the meeting. The Conservatives gave their apologies, so we hope to see them at some future date. It is entirely wrong to suggest that there has been no strategy. On general terms, the inward investment strategy of Scottish Enterprise is being implemented all the time, and the member will be aware that, according to independent EY report, Scotland is more successful than any part of the UK other than London at attracting inward investment. I myself have played a modest part in that by, for example, meeting the chief executives of companies such as FMC and Oceaneering, who are both based in Fife, whilst visiting Houston on several occasions over the years. And I'm very pleased that in Scottish and Highlands and Islands Enterprise and SDI, we have a team that are working around the clock on these issues. It is entirely unfair to them to suggest that they have not been working away behind the scenes, and they continue to do so. But we are acutely aware of the impact on businesses, and of course we are redoubling our efforts to make sure that every potential opportunity to provide alternative business and employment is pursued.
Lord Campbell, followed by Claire Baker.
Could the Minister outline what recent steps the UK Government has taken to work with the Scottish Government to create an environment that incentivises the huge potential of clean thermal technologies such as carbon capture and storage?
Minister.
Well, I am working with the UK Government there anent, with particular regard to progressing the Summit Power Captain Clean Energy Scheme, and both Scottish and UK Governments have contributed financial contributions toward that. This would be a 500 megawatt scheme, which would generate clean energy from coal with pre-combustion CCS. I hope it will get the support of everybody, including the Greens, since it's the only way to tackle climate change effectively. And it would also deliver enormous economic benefits. So we are working with that. I will discuss that with Amber Rudd on the 21st of September, and I'm very grateful to have the opportunity to make that point today.
Claire Baker, followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Longannet is very worrying for the Fife economy, and as the Minister knows, it comes on the back of other closures and redundancies recently. The statement refers to discussions with the UK Government on the carbon price support mechanism proposal. If these discussions are not successful, will the Scottish Government consider supporting and funding a similar measure for the Scottish coal industry? And can I also ask if the Minister can say more about the plans that are for the long-term future of the Longannet site, and who is responsible for future restoration of that site?
Minister.
Well, we worked hard with the Opencast Task Force, which I think has met 13 times, in order to persuade the UK Government to work with us to produce a scheme based upon the coal industry scheme of the restoration plan. That would involve an exemption from the carbon price support mechanism. Those matters are entirely reserved. They're entirely within the UK Government's gift. They enjoyed the in-principle support of David Mundell, the Scottish Secretary. Mr. Mundell has a constituency interest, but I think that he has been supportive of this. I therefore hope that he will continue to be supportive of this, and he will use all the influence that he has and that he can command as the Scottish Secretary to persuade the UK Treasury to say yes and not no. And therefore, we will take that forward optimistically and do so as a matter of urgency.
Kenneth Gibson, followed by Claudia Beaman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, the operators of Hunterston Coal Terminal in my constituency, Peel Ports Group, has announced that a consultation will be held with the site's 95 staff following the decision to close Longannet in expectation of significant redundancies. Will the Scottish Government and its agencies work with Peel Ports Group to explore alternative uses for the terminal, which is suitable for the import and export of a wide range of bulk solids and liquid products and offshore decommissioning, and whilst exploring all available options to minimise the number of redundancies, will he ensure that the partnership action for continuing employment is available to assist any Hunterston employee threatened with redundancy?
Minister.
Yes, we will. We have, of course, offered pay support to the Peel Ports Group in respect of the impact that the closure next year of Longannet Power Station is expected to have on them. I can also say that their representative attended both the task force meeting and also the round table supply chain meeting, so we are already working close with them. I did in fact refer to Mr Gibson's sterling efforts in campaigning on this issue in the course of the round table event which I chaired on Monday of this week. We are meeting and engaging closely with the company to see what can conceivably be done to assist them to meet the very serious impacts that this closure will face on many, many businesses in Scotland. This is not just about one power station, hugely significant though that is. This is about hundreds of companies that are impacted by the results of a decision that should have been avoided if the UK government had been prepared to lift a finger.
Claudia Beamish, followed by Patrick Harvey.
Looking to the future, how will the Scottish Government prevent the same transitional issues arising again with thermal plant closures and other changes by ensuring that there is now a robust strategy to manage the inevitable shift to a low-carbon economy through a just transition with the unions for workers and communities across Scotland, including those impacted by knock-on and supply chain effects such as at Clydeport?
Minister.
Well, I think the problems that I've outlined already of higher charges for Scotland and England for exactly the same power stations mean that we can devise any strategy that we want, but that strategy in itself will not alter the basic realities of the arithmetic, that no company is going to invest in one part of a country where the charges are three times as higher than another part of the country. And sadly it was, and I have to repeat this, the Labour government introduced this discriminatory system in 2005. So our strategy, as the former First Minister has advocated for about a decade, is to have a fair system for Scotland. And of course that then would allow us to manage the transition to a low carbon energy policy.
Patrick Harvey, then finally Angus MacDonald.
Thank you. It's not just Scotland, but the whole world which is coming to recognise finally that we can't keep burning coal to produce our electricity. As the decision this week to have early closure of a coal-fired power station in Yorkshire demonstrates, this is not just a Scottish issue. Aren't we facing a situation where the long-term planning for that transition is what's lacking? Isn't it clear that the requirement for an immediate decision to set up a PACE working group only when plants close, only when businesses close and redundancies are announced, that's inadequate. We need a much longer-term planning arrangement so that we invest the profits of outgoing industries in the development of the new.
Minister?
Well, first of all, it would be a bit strange if we set up PACE activity before people face redundancy. I mean, that would be absurd. It's a task force that helps people who are made redundant. That's the whole point of PACE. Secondly, to take his major point, of course we have a strategy. It's set out in our electricity policy generation statement. If he hasn't read it, I can provide him easily with a copy. But I suspect that he is aware of it. And of course, a major part of it is that we do need to have a continued backup and baseload. In the EGPS, which was brought forward just a couple of years ago, it recommended that we would require continuing around 2.5 gigawatts of thermal generating capacity, increasingly progressively fitted with carbon capture and storage. And therefore, we do have a strategy, carbon capture and storage, clean energy from fossil fuel, removing the carbon emissions, supported by the International Energy Authority, supported by green groups in the USA. But apparently, although it is a sine qua non of achieving climate change targets, not supported by the party that, that advocates this case most fervently on most other occasions. So I think, not for the first occasion, Presiding Officer, Mr Harvey and I will have to agree to disagree.
Finally, Angus MacDonald.
There will clearly be knock-on effects from the closure to supply chain companies. For example, there's over 30 train drivers transporting coal into Longannet, plus shunter drivers, signalmen and fitters, many of them living in my constituency. I've been approached by train drivers at Longannet who would wish to retrain to allow them to transfer from freight to passenger transport. Will PACE assist with retraining of the drivers if requested?
Minister.
Yeah, well, I'm grateful for a sensible question, Presiding Officer, and we can confirm that PACE has been in contact with DB Schenker to offer support. I was very pleased that DB Schenker attended the roundtable meeting. I was also grateful that ASLEF and other unions made exactly that point that Mr MacDonald has rightly made on behalf of his constituents. We are absolutely determined to make sure that all the practical steps that we can do to tackle the immediate and direct consequences of the closure of Longannet next year are taken, and I'm therefore undertaking and happy to continue to work very closely with the company and with their workforce representatives, as well as Angus MacDonald, who has pursued this matter very robustly indeed.
Thank you. That ends the statement from the Minister. My sincere apologies to the two members I couldn't call, but I have let this run on for 5 minutes longer than scheduled. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 14048 in the name of Murdo Fraser on the economic impact of the film, TV and video games industries. Members who wish to take part in the debate should press the request button now.
And we call on Murdo Fraser to start the debate. Mr Fraser, you have 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Parliamentary reports come and go. This one happens to be the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee's 47th report of this session. I've counted them all out and I've counted them all in. A few wins, a number of defeats, many a scoreless draw. But sometimes you get a report that cuts through the morass, the fog of bureaucracy, and finds itself in real danger of making a tangible impact. This could be about timing, it could be about asking the right questions, it could simply be the power of the evidence that the committee has heard. And the response you get is more than cursory or polite or, in the phrasing of Eric Blair, designed to give appearance of solidity to pure wind. And this is one of these times. The committee's report on the economic impact of the film, TV and video games industries has been rather well received. And I've been through the Scottish Government's response with my red pen and made a good many more ticks than I was expecting. Double ticks even, particularly where the words agrees or accepts or welcomes appear, and they appear frequently. That the Scottish Government, along with Creative Scotland, Scottish Enterprise and others, has accepted so many of our recommendations is indeed pleasing. I've been called a few things in my time, Deputy Presiding Officer, but churlish isn't one of them. So I'm pleased to report we even managed to coax a pair of Cabinet Secretaries along to our final evidence session, two for the price of one. Now the test, of course, will be putting the policy statements into practice. Fiona Hislop has said so herself. We will wait and see what comes of the work of the newly announced Film Industry Leadership Group. The committee is looking for credible leadership, an inclusive approach, expert and timely advice, sustainable funding, coordination of agencies, nurturing of new talent, and that apparently perennial but now most pressing of issues, the need for a film and TV studio here in Scotland. Now, I suspect we all have a favourite Scottish film. It might be Trainspotting, it might be The Prime of Miss Jean Brodie, it might be Local Hero, it might be Sunshine on Leith. But I wonder how many of us know how much the Scottish film industry is worth. Well, the answer is £30 million. £30 million. Put that into context. How much is the UK film industry worth? It is worth £1 billion. We're punching so much below our weight that we're barely tickling the potential of what could be achieved. It might be going too far to borrow an expression from Gandhi. When asked what he thought of Western civilization, he said, "I think it would be a good idea." It might be just a little bit too harsh to say when asked what I think of the Scottish film industry. I think it would be a good idea. But we have to ask, where are the next Scottish films going to come from, the next local hero, the next prime of Miss Jean Brodie? And the answer is, I'm afraid, unlikely to be made here in Scotland, not unless we are more serious about upping our game. Presiding officer, the creative industries matter to our economy, and we ought to be supporting, sustaining and celebrating them accordingly. The Scottish Government estimates the sector is worth £5 billion plus, employs more people than oil and gas, and boasts a higher GVA than life sciences. Our inquiry considered three areas. Film, I've touched on briefly. TV, I'll come to video games, the passion of my children, indeed many adults, I suspect. I'll keep that till last. Plenty of us, I'm sure, are fans of Game of Thrones. But do we know that the people who made it originally wanted to film in Scotland? Ian Smith of the British Film Commission told us that tale in evidence. The makers knew that Scotland was bigger and could offer more locations, but there just wasn't the shooting space inside. A show like that, he told us, can't be made entirely on location. It wouldn't work. So up stepped Northern Ireland. They had Titanic Studios, which sealed the deal, and the rest is history. Well, if not history exactly, a story of ambition, sex, warmongering, murder and dragons. You can draw your own comparison with Scottish politics today. Perhaps we have fewer dragons. And a story now earning Northern Ireland's economy some £40 million a year. And on the back of Game of Thrones, they have, of course, built a wider TV and film industry based in Belfast. The TV industry here declared itself to be, in the words of one witness, depressed and disillusioned. They wanted to know what the strategy was for better supporting the independent sector. They wanted less reliance on lift and shift, so more programmes could be made in Scotland and in a more sustainable way. And they wanted broadcasters to look beyond the limited, and some would say myopic, vision of London-based commissioners. But let's not be excessively glum, Presiding Officer. There are good stories to tell, too. Take Outlander, a huge TV success in the US, described, would you believe, as a feminist Game of Thrones. It's filmed entirely in Scotland, some of it in a studio at Cumbernauld, some on location, including at Duncastle and Cooross, both of which happen to be in the region I represent. And I believe Visit Scotland are drooling at the potential for bumper visitor numbers on the back of this. The numbers that relate to the video games industry in Scotland are something we can all shout about. We have just round the corner now Rockstar North, our new neighbours in the old Scotsman building. And they have their mind-bogglingly successful Grand Theft Auto V and every child's favourite 4J Studios all-conquering Minecraft. Scotland has in these two of the world's fastest-selling entertainment products ever. That's extraordinary, Presiding Officer. And perhaps we haven't always appreciated the scale of that success or understood what the sector needs to sustain it. Creative Scotland's Janet Archer told us as much. 4J Studios' Chris van der Kyle acknowledged the support the fledgling industry had received during the 1990s from Scottish Enterprise. This is not a bleating session, he told the committee. It would still be possible to gather the key players from the companies and agencies into one room to produce a coherent plan. Video games, he said, could transform Scotland into the Seattle of Europe. However, the evidence showed that we want those involved in developing the games to be more entrepreneurial and the agencies supporting them to be more agile in working alongside such a fast-moving industry. The so-called gamification of other areas, whether it's education, health or tourism, is a fascinating development. Minecraft has been described as the world's single biggest educational tool. And we were told of games companies in Glasgow and Dundee working in collaboration with Cancer Research UK. A glimpse of the future. Back to the here and now, and there are two specific matters that came out in our report I'd like to raise with the Cabinet Secretary, and I'd be grateful if she could try and address both of these in the course of the afternoon. First and foremost is the film studio. We heard in our evidence just how important it is to Scottish producers, both in film and TV, that we have the studio capacity here in Scotland. At one time, recently, there seemed to be three separate bids coming forward, at least three. There might be more. One at Lonehead, one in Cumbernauld, one in Glasgow. So we need to know what is happening with this. What is the latest and what happens next? We understand the Scottish Government cannot set up a film studio, cannot entirely fund a film studio. But how are we going to decide which of these projects finds favour, and what is the process for getting there, and what is the likely timescale? The second key point is the working relationship between Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise, or, I should say, the non-working relationship. Whether this was a clash of cultures, or a clash of personality, or a case of conflicting priorities, the evidence was that it was simply not harmonious. One witness even imagined the behind-the-scenes conflict as being on a par with Borgen. I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will update us on the latest episode in this drama, perhaps with a happy and preferably non-fictitious ending. And it's a serious point, because the success of our creative industries is reliant upon coherent leadership. Presiding Officer, just to close, the Scottish Government has declared its ambition for Scotland to be one of the world's leading creative nations. All those working in film, TV and video games share that ambition, and the committee shares that ambition. We have the talent, we have the locations, and we have the innovation. We have all the necessary ingredients. But we must turn the bold statements and best of intentions into solid actions and sustainable outcomes. Presiding Officer, I commend this report to the Chamber, and I have great pleasure in moving the motion in my name. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I now call on Fiona Hurst, Cabinet Secretary. You have 7 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and also to the committee convener for his opening remarks. I do welcome the inquiry in this debate as an opportunity to shine the spotlight on the sector. Very timely, because it does come at a time of significant development for the sector, and I think it does show the Parliament at its best if it can look at a sector as important as this to provide recommendations and to see as part of the development that we respond to those recommendations, but also it's happening at a time where so much is happening that we can share, and I think we're in a good time for momentum for the sector, but much to be done. He's also very correct to identify the sheer scale of success of Outlander and the success it has, not just in promoting Scotland, but also in providing jobs and skills and production, and that is very significant indeed at this time. The Scottish Government provided a very full response to the committee's inquiry report on 28th of May. I look forward to seeing the ticks and the double ticks from Murdo Fraser if he forwards them to me. As outlined in that response, we have already actioned a number of the recommendations. The Government published Scotland's economic strategy in March this year. The creative industries were reaffirmed in that strategy as one of our key growth sectors. The creative industries employ more people than the oil and gas industry in Scotland and generates a higher GVA than the life sciences sector. And we said that quite deliberately, because it's really important that we give the space and the time and the attention for this sector, as other sectors also receive within the purview of either public sector or indeed government. Support for the creative industries has also been articulated in our programme for government. And in that context, the Deputy First Minister and I have made clear in response to Murdo Fraser, to Scottish Enterprise and Creative Scotland, that a memorandum of understanding needs to be in place to ensure clarity of respective roles and which sets out effective joint working to ensure the coordination of support from these agencies to the sector. This was an issue identified by the committee, is one we're very conscious and able of, and I think in the process of the last few months we've made significant progress in bringing those agencies together and their focus of how they can work collectively. So I welcome... yes, indeed.
I'm grateful to her for giving way. On the subject of the memorandum of understanding, the government said pretty clearly in its response that it was a priority and it would be set up and in place by August. Has that happened?
In terms of the progress, I am also committed to ensure updates to the committee in terms of the timing of the memorandum of understanding, the release of that, and to make sure that the committee is kept abreast, as with the industry. One of the things that has happened over the summer, perhaps, to make you aware of, is that Scottish Enterprise and Creative Scotland have been meeting with the industries to see exactly their understanding of the importance of the clarifications of those roles. I also want to focus on some of the four areas that the committee focused on itself. On the screen area, the committee recommended that the Scottish Government evaluates what further support or incentives it could provide to the Scottish screen sector. The film studio, of course, is still subject to negotiation with the private partner, and progress is being made. But as the committee inquiry itself found, a studio on its own is not the only answer, and it is important to have additional incentives to stimulate interest and investment from the private sector in our screen sector and to enable us to compete with other locations. And that is why I'm pleased to inform the Parliament that the Scottish Government and Creative Scott have today launched a new £1.75 million production growth fund for film and TV. And the fund, which will run over 2015-17, is expected to attract more large-scale film and TV productions to Scotland and is the latest in a series of measures taken by the Scottish Government and its agencies to support the Scottish screen sector to grow. The Production Growth Fund and the £3 million of additional support from film production skills development I announced earlier this year further enhances the package of public support for the screen sector over 2015-16. Now, new figures show that public sector screen support for 2014-15 totaled more than £24.1 million, and that is an increase of over £2.5 million from 2013-14, and an increase of almost £8 million since 2007-08. And in difficult times, people might recognise in the Chamber the progress that we are making. So I hope you appreciate and welcome that ongoing support. On video games, another set of welcome figures are those recently published by TIGA, the Network for Game Developers and Digital Publishers, and they show that the employment in the Scottish video games development sector grew by 9% in 2014. Now, this means that Scotland now represents 11.1% of the UK's total games companies, compared to 8.8% in 2012. Scotland also represents 9.7% of the UK's total games developer headcount, which is up from 9% in 2012. So these figures are extremely encouraging. I also agree with the committee's recommendations, however, that a detailed review and analysis of the Scottish video game sector is required to understand the financial and business support it requires. And Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise are therefore taking forward an initial process of monitoring the video game sector through a set of surveys that will be conducted over the coming year, and they will be produced in collaboration with the Scottish Games Network. And the outcomes of this survey will ensure that the public sector support is tailored to the needs of the video game sector, enabling it to grow and develop further. In addition, the digital media strategy will launch this month. It will be followed by a series of focus sessions with subsectors such as video games to promote the strategy's messages, bring the creative industries that utilise digital technology into the implementation of the strategy. The committee also made a number of recommendations in relation to a sustainable Scottish television sector, and I'm already working with the broadcasting sector to determine what changes might be required to achieve a sustainable and growing sector. And the First Minister recently outlined the kind of federal model for the BBC as part of the charter renewal, which we believe will allow the sector to achieve this. I'm also pleased that the government recently signed the Memorandum of Understanding, along with the Scottish Parliament, which will take forward some of the renewal process. And we're currently in discussion with a range of stakeholders in developing policy options for broadcasting. I intend to discuss with all parties in this Parliament the emerging ideas which are gathering support. So collectively, we have the opportunity to influence the BBC, particularly on the need to abandon the reliance on lift and shift, as identified in the committee's report, to increase commissioning and production, and to increase the skills and expertise within the Scottish TV sector. On skills, in relation to the skills aspect, Skills Development Scotland has published its skills investment plan for the creative industries. That was done at the end of June. They have set up a skills forum to implement the plan. The actions identified in the plan will enhance the sector. It follows the launch of the ICT and Digital Technologies Skills Investment Plan in March, which also came from Skills Development Scotland, with £6.6 million from the Scottish Government. So in terms of promoting that, I think you'll see not only are there plans under production also being effected, but also being supported by funding. So I'm very conscious, Presiding Officer, it's a very short speaking slot. I've touched on a number of key areas, I think, arising from the inquiry. I would refer members to the full response from the 28th of May, and it is my intention to write to the committee convener shortly with a more detailed update on the progress against all the recommendations set out by the committee. But I do welcome the debate. It's very timely. It's an exciting sector for Scotland, and let's take this forward. Thank you very much.
Excellent. Many thanks. Now call on Claire Baker. Up to 5 minutes, please.
President Officer, I'd like to start by thanking the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee for providing such a wide-ranging and engaging report into the creative industries in Scotland. They seem to have been very effective, with money announced the morning that the Cabinet Secretary was due to give evidence to the committee, and money announced this morning as we are about to have the debate this afternoon. So I'm very pleased it was the Economy Committee that took the decision to have this inquiry. With over 100,000 jobs, over £12 billion in turnover and over £6 billion in gross value added, the economic contribution of the arts and the creative industries must not be underplayed. The committee's report does raise many important points that we must engage with in this short debate. This includes a film and TV studio in Scotland. When I first took on the spokesperson role for Labour, it appeared to be imminent. There had certainly been a lot of interest in Scotland, as Murdo Fraser highlighted, but so far nothing has come to fruition. In these 9 months, we have seen action, not in Scotland, but from Screen Yorkshire, who announced in June their plans for a new film studio just outside of Leeds. This is further competition to the sector in Scotland, and Screen Yorkshire has already started to show productions around their potential studio. But Scotland does have the skills and the talent to be at the forefront of the film and TV sector, not just here in the UK, but throughout the world. But we do lack a studio. We have seen the recent successes of films shot in Scotland, including World War Z and Sunshine on Leith, and high-quality TV dramas such as Outlander. But for every Outlander, there is a Game of Thrones, and that was a major production that was missed due in part to the lack of studio infrastructure. And all too often, Scotland's rising talent does feel the need and the urge to go further afield to fulfil their potential. If we had a film studio in Scotland, a TV studio, that would go a long way towards ensuring that skills and talents could be retained and developed within Scotland. But we also need clear leadership, and one of the issues raised by the report was the confusion over the roles of Scottish Government, Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise. We need clearer leadership from these organisations to ensure that we have a sustainable sector and a vibrant Scottish film and TV scene. And the Cabinet Secretary did talk about the Memorandum of Understanding, and in reply to Gavin Brown, it would appear that this seems to be still quite a challenging situation, and we don't have that Memorandum of Understanding yet. Is she confident that the commitment of all partners is there to deliver in this sector? It was welcome that this report and the evidence taken by the committee do seem to have forced the government into action. And in May, we saw the creation of a film industry leadership group. So welcome was this group by the Scottish Government that they've announced it three times in the space of three paragraphs in Tuesday's programme for government. There might be a typo in there, but there seems to be quite a lot of repetition of a certain paragraph. This must only be the start, because while we recognise the economic significance of the creative industries, Scotland spends only £6.9 million on film. One area in which support could be increased, and an area that must also be debated in the context of the BBC Charter renewal, is that of lift and shift. The quotas set by Ofcom for original production amongst public service broadcasters are being met, and that is welcome news. But the policy of lift and shift can be detrimental to the sector in the long run, failing to provide employment opportunities for the local TV industry. And if we are to develop a sustainable TV sector in Scotland, then this policy must be improved and bring greater value to the sector. So I was encouraged in the report by the committee to see that the BBC have acknowledged this and recognised the policy was a short-term mechanism to accelerate investment, and that now they needed to ensure the companies that are based in Scotland are winning entirely new businesses and are drawing from the local population and talent base. Beyond lift and shift, the charter renewal process must also look at the competitive challenges facing the BBC in the years ahead. I'm not convinced that the solution to this is the creation of a Scottish-only channel, and I've yet to see evidence that this is what the Scottish public are calling out for. The cost of setting up such a channel would be considerable, and at a time when the BBC is essentially having its budget cut by the UK government, we must ask if this is an appropriate use of the licence fee payers' money. Nor do I believe that a federal system within the BBC is the answer. This would be the first step towards the breakup of the BBC and a weakening of the corporation. And in the First Minister's reply at FMQs today, this certainly looked like it was more about politics and control rather than about what is best for licence fee payers. This model also raises concerns that, as we saw with STV and Downton Abbey, if we move to a situation of buying and selling programmes, popular programmes could be shown in other parts of the UK that wouldn't be available in Scotland. Presiding Officer, if we want to be bold and radical, then we must face up to the challenges and opportunities that are ahead of the BBC in their future and address these. The world of broadcasting is changing rapidly. We're seeing BBC Three being moved online. More and more people are using the iPlayer or accessing Netflix or some other kind of models. And we need to be more imaginative in finding solutions. If not, I fear that the BBC is at risk of being attacked by the Conservatives while squeezed by the SNP. Presiding Officer, the committee have done an excellent job in highlighting this sector, and I thank them for their work.
Many thanks. I now call on Gavin Brown. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, thank you. Can I start too by commending the committee for their excellent work, for a very robust report and something which I think has already made a practical difference and will continue to do so. The government, though, of course, will not be judged by its written response to the report. It will be judged by the action that flows and actually takes place on the ground as a consequence of the report. We should be very proud of our film, TV, animation and video games industries. But there is much more to be done, and we frankly should be doing a lot better than we currently are. Now, I want to pick up, first of all, on one of the bits that jumped out in the report to me. It was the lack of coordination between Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise. I wasn't on the committee, so I didn't hear it firsthand, but reading through the report, it jumps off the page at you. Ian Smith of the British Film Commission said it wasn't systematically set up to deal with the configuration of the business. Ken Hay says they work in isolation. Bob Last, an independent producer, said that the agencies have been set up to fail. And the committee concluded, without anyone disagreeing, at paragraph 76, the separate and distinct remits of Scottish Enterprise and Creative Scotland are acting as a barrier to working cohesively to effectively support the film industry. Now, in committee speak, Deputy Presiding Officer, that is a damning conclusion. That is a conclusion that should have, frankly, shocked the Scottish Government and pushed them into action. Yet 5 months down the line, it's difficult to establish what the progress actually is. We even had Creative Scotland giving evidence, saying Creative Scotland had not been set up in a way that enabled it to engage with other public bodies. I had to read that several times to make sure that I'd read that correctly, but I think I did. It was actually set up so that it couldn't engage with other public bodies. So when I asked the Cabinet Secretary today what has happened with the Memorandum of Understanding, I was disappointed with the response. I assumed the response was no. It wasn't stated quite as clearly as that. But the government in its response said that is what they were going to do. They were going to host a series of workshops. They were going to establish clear links, and all of this would culminate in a memorandum of understanding between Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise, and it would be published by August 2015. Clearly, it wasn't published by August 2015, but it's not even clear at this stage when it will be published and what the barriers actually are. And I have to say, of course I'll give way.
Very briefly, the workshops have been taking place. The memorandum of understanding will be published, but the Scottish the Creative Industries Partnership, which brings together the bodies, only met on Monday, so the timing as to whether that could be released at this time might mean that the August date has been missed.
Gavin Brown.
Presiding Officer, I'm not sure if I'm more confident or less confident after hearing that response. It's set out in a formal response to a committee by two Cabinet Secretaries that this body or this memorandum will be published by August. 5 months down the line, we're just saying it will be published. We don't actually know when it will be published. And if it's taken that long to get to a memorandum of understanding, then it doesn't fill me, I have to say, with excitement about where we're going to take things. So I think the Scottish Government needs to do far better in that area. Presiding Officer, clearly there are a number of structural changes that were announced by the Cabinet Secretary, either in the response or later today, which would be welcomed. And I think the fresh funding, whether it flowed from today's debate or not, is not hugely important in my view. The fact that the funding has been announced should be welcomed. But obviously, we won't hear the results of how it's going to function until, I think, later on. And so we obviously want to see that's right, because I think there were a couple of other funds. I noticed Murdo Fraser's questioning of the Cabinet Secretary during the committee stage about the loan fund for studio development, where none of that money, certainly at the time, had been drawn down. It's great to announce these things, but it's important that the money is drawn down and actually flows to where we want it to flow. In my final minute, Presiding Officer, I do want to touch on the video game sector, because I was struck by the quote that we could and want to become the Seattle of Europe. I think that's a terrific ambition. But if we're going to do that, we have to have far better figures and knowledge of the economic impact of the video games industry. This is a dynamic, quickly evolving industry, but when I look at the Scottish Government's response to the committee, we're still relying on figures from 2013 for employment and 2012 figures for turnover. That's a couple of years' gap. When you think that employment doubled between 2011 and 2013, I have to say we're not going to become the Seattle of Europe if we're relying on figures that are 2 years out of date. You're making that signal at me, Presiding Officer, so I'm content to leave it there. Thank you.
Many thanks. And we now move to the open debate. And I call on Christian Allard to be followed by Joanne Lamont. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Thank you very much. And it's a bit difficult to come just after Gavin Brown because I thought with the starting of the convener of the committee that we were going into a very consensual debate where we saw that the Parliament works very well, when committees work very well, even aided by somebody from the opposition, and when government responds that with this amount of funding. I would like to make my plea today for my region, for the North East of Scotland, on the back of this debate. Presiding Officer, a few weeks ago, I was denied a visit to the fantastic harbour of Port Sawyer. A couple of security personnel with an accent I recognised to be from Glasgow told me it was a remake of Whiskey Galore based on the true story of the SS politician, chose Port Sawyer as a prime location. And I asked them in my well-recognised North East accent where else was the shooting taking place, and they told me that it was taking place all over the East Coast, in Pennon. They were the day before in Pennon, in the home of the iconic red phone box, and they were going down to Fife later on in the week, where, of course, a lot of the popular TV series Outlander was shot. All this location quite far away from where those two gentlemen came from, I pointed out to them. They weren't complaining, the weather was fantastic. Presiding Officer, but episode a few weeks ago, after this encounter, I came to me that the film industry in Scotland should be based in a central location, and I give you Dundee. Over the last few decades, Dundee and the North East of Scotland has developed and established a well-respected place within the growing industry of film, TV and video game, one which is highlighted in this report from the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. I am delighted that the committee looked at this because film, TV and video games are primary industries that generate, as we heard already, employment and a vast amount of revenue for Scotland. This Parliament recognises the true economic value, so does this government. President, let me make my case for Dundee and the North East to the Scottish Film Studio Delivery Group. The main reason for the success of Dundee in this industry is not only about its central location, but it's about the creativity of its people and their ability to attract creative people to live and work in the North East. I can cite Aberdeen film director, producer John Byrne, or the global hit computer puzzle game whose creator first met at Dundee Computer Club. The economic and cultural impacts that come from the creative industries are clear, strong and evident in the report published in March this year. I thank the committee for their acknowledgement and plans to review the current overarching lift and shift arrangement from the large producing companies which are based in Scotland. This method used in the television and film industry is discarding another generation of Scottish talents and products. In a bid to enrich and maintain the creative industry in Scotland and provide opportunities, it would be highlighted valuable for the new purpose-built film studio to be based in the North East, to be based in Dundee. The city of Dundee understood as a small city of the future by the small society lab has a long-rich history in the creative industry. The promising future of Dundee could be made present with a new studio and could exceed current aspirations for video gaming, TV and film. Everything under one roof in Dundee. A last point I would like to make, it's about an article who was in The National from Kevin McKenna. He was talking about the BBC TV production, Bob Servant. As Kevin puts it, he said it was the infantile Bob Servant, which is about as funny as ducking for chips. And Mr. McKenna added, who needs England to misrepresent us when we seem perfectly capable of doing it ourselves? That's a fair point, Presiding Officer, to the journalist. But the first time I listened to Bob Servant, it was on the BBC Radio Scotland, and it was a fantastic programme which maybe didn't convert so well in television, but I think we need to give time to this industry to flourish and to make sure we can produce as good programmes as we can do in the future. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call on Joanne Lamont to be followed by Gordon MacDonald. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I add my thanks to the witnesses who came before the committee. It was an important inquiry, and I was very struck by the evident hunger by many in the film and television industry and the video games industry for this inquiry, and also the robust way in which they took the opportunity to highlight their concerns about the circumstances in which they are operating. And I think the challenge for this Parliament is not, frankly, to sit and hug each other about how it was a great inquiry, because the test will be if we respond to that anger, that frustration and that sense of concern about what is happening in the sector. We cannot just become another part of what has been a very dispiriting process for far too many people in film and TV in particular. And I think we should be concerned at what the evidence showed, the clear frustration and resignation. The stark contrast, in my view, between the energy of the sector, the fleet of foot in business terms, developing new ideas, taking risks, creating opportunities for skills and talents to thrive, coming up against what seemed an unbelievably slow bureaucratic process, which seemed to think that having meetings about important issues was the same as taking action on these issues. And I must say to the Cabinet Secretary, an explanation that we haven't fulfilled a commitment to have a memorandum of understanding in August is because they didn't meet till Monday is not any kind of response. And I am sure that over the weeks and the months and years, the people within that sector have heard that kind of explanation too often. We do need to move on this, because I think the scale of frustration is a matter of concern. And I am concerned, actually, at even the response of the Scottish Government to some of these key issues. The key issue about Scottish Enterprise and Creative Scotland working together is not about working practices, it's actually about supporting the sector. And yet we are told, we acknowledge that our communication for the suite of services needs to be improved. It needs to be far more serious than that. And also on the question of the film studio, well, we might argue where it's going to be, we're not even at first base and whether it's actually going to happen. And the paragraph from the Scottish Government on that is also dispiriting, an explanation of how difficult and complex things are when people are crying out for that need. I only have a short time to speak, and I just want to make a couple of important points. Firstly, we need to be clear this is not just a cultural issue and how we enrich and support artistic talent. It is about how economically we can benefit from a thriving film, TV and video games industry, and how in our budget decisions we recognise the need to create the infrastructure to support that industry like we do to others. This is not subsidising creativity. It is rational investment in a sector of huge potential economically, with knock-on effects to the broader economy and, for example, to tourism. It is a rational investment to allow Scottish companies to compete. It is, as we see, that a recent report suggests that an £11 million investment to secure the Game of Thrones series in Northern Ireland resulted in a £491 million economic benefit over 4 years. That is why we need to up our game, because by not acting, we are not simply leaving things as they are. Things are deteriorating. We are behind. We are falling behind Wales and Northern Ireland, and now we see initiatives in places like Manchester and Yorkshire too. And this problem is encapsulated by this issue of the studio. It's not just a big space, but it is about the lack of infrastructure that sees Scotland hampered. Glasgow won the Commonwealth Games not just because it was good at sport, because 70% of its venues were built before the bid went in, and the broader facilities available in transport, hotels and so on were recognised. And that's why I support a film studio in Glasgow, part of the media village, with room for a film school and room for expansion, which would fund itself in short term. We need a can-do approach. The people who came to our committee don't want us to pat ourselves on the back. We all care about it. We must now make sure the recommendations are acted upon and those voices allow the economy to benefit from a thriving creative film, TV and video industry.
Thanks so much. Now Colin Gordon-MacDonald to be followed by Drew Smith. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The arts and creative industries employ 130,000 people and contribute £6.3 billion to the economy of Scotland. The video games industry is one of the successful parts of Scotland's creative industries, producing international best-selling games in Grand Theft Auto and Minecraft. We have groundbreaking university courses at both Abertay and Glasgow Caledonia, and some of the largest companies in the games industry are located in Dundee and Edinburgh. But it's the less successful areas of creative arts we need to examine if we are to continue to grow this area of our economy. The television sector is a combination of public sector broadcasters and independent television production companies who employ 1,700 people in Scotland. In order to grow the television industry here, Scottish producers need to get a larger share of the £100 million the BBC spends on programmes in Scotland. This is especially important as the budget is due to drop to £87 million in 2017. Meaning that only one quarter of the licence fee of £320 million currently raised in Scotland will be spent in Scotland. In recent years, television production has been increasing, with the BBC reporting that in 2013, nearly 11% of the network budget was spent in Scotland, and Channel 4 was achieving just under 4% on Scottish productions. Yet witnesses informed us of the difficulties they had experienced in gaining access to commissioners in London, with no responses to either phone calls or emails requesting meetings to discuss ideas for programmes. Alan Clements emphasised the importance of getting Scottish ideas back on network television, particularly high-end drama. He considered that to achieve this, the industry needed commissioners based in Scotland, focusing on increasing Scottish-based production. So if Scottish producers don't get access to commissioners, then how does the public sector broadcasters meet the Ofcom quota? Much of the increase in production in recent years is due to a policy of lift and shift by the broadcasters, where production companies temporarily move to Scotland, bringing up their own film crews, actors, technicians and production staff, and return south when filming is over. Drew McFarlane of Equity explained that moving a production to a national or regional area and moving actors there too impacted on local actors gaining valuable employment and experience. Jane Muirhead of PACT highlighted that lift and shift frustrates the whole idea of building sustainable businesses because the intellectual property and the revenue remains out with Scotland. But it's not just BBC funding that the television sector has difficulty accessing. Creative Europe is the European Commission's new programme to support the cultural, creative and audiovisual sectors with a budget of nearly €1.5 billion over the next 6 years to 2020. Connect Film suggested that it was hard to access the fund as Scotland was defined as being part of the UK, meaning that Scotland did not achieve the necessary points given for projects from countries with low audiovisual production capacity. In order to build a sustainable television sector, we need to emulate the success of the video games industry. The committee has called on the BBC and Channel 4 to abandon their reliance on lift and shift in favour of investing in production by independent TV companies with a permanent base in Scotland, and to increase the number of commissioners based in Scotland and engaging effectively with the industry. With the new powers coming to this Parliament in relation to the scrutiny of the BBC, I'm sure that members of the EET committee will ensure that it has met its production and spend quotas for Scotland
but also that the impact of its policies on our Indigenous TV industry is a positive one.
Let's draw to a close. Thanks very much. Thanks. Now Colin Drew-Smith, to be followed by John McAlpine.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm glad of the opportunity to take part in this debate and, like others, grateful to the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee for the report. And I just wanted to, I suppose, focus on the film and TV industries, as those have been the areas where I've certainly been contacted by constituents about their experience in the industry and indeed their concerns for the future. And one did tell me that he just didn't believe that officials realise how important the Scottish film industry is or the potential that it has. And it might be of interest to the Chamber then to hear some of those comments that I have certainly heard from my constituents in Glasgow of people working in the industry, and I hope that would be of value as part of this debate. The Scottish film industry is lagging far behind the rest of the UK. There are incredibly talented people here who just cannot get the work and have to travel away from home, not through choice, but through necessity to get work suited to their skills. That might seem glamorous, but it's hard to be away from friends and family in your home. Your life is put on hold. Your life is, and it has an effect upon the people, other people to which you're related. That individual said she was not alone in feeling this way, and she believed that, in fact, we had a dying industry in Scotland, and that one of the consequences of this was hostility within the business itself. She talked about the work is so thin on the ground that it breeds distrust in others talking about the few jobs that actually come up. There is nobody issuing a list of jobs about to start, so it's all word of mouth. Until a person secures a job, they will not tell anyone else about it for fear of not getting that work themselves. If there was plenty of work around, there might be the right person for the job would be picked, and there might be a buzz about what was happening. Some of the things that have been told are indeed reflected in the committee's report, and that, I think that most notably others have referred to it, is this lack of understanding and coordination between Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise, neither of whom can claim to have done a good job for this industry, and I think that really just isn't good enough. I've also heard frustration about the lack of a studio, and we've discussed that already. There's also irritation and cynicism that something that has been talked about for so long hasn't happened. But there are also hopes for what could be achieved. And the point to me is not just that it's about a big empty space to put production, but what we will actually need now is creating a quality facility, because Scotland is already behind so many of the competitors. Our studio facility, if it's to be built, would have to offer something different, something above and beyond what could be achieved elsewhere. And the point has also been made to me that many of the skills in the industry, and it's been well made to me, are indeed in and around Glasgow. And therefore, I certainly take the view that a facility there would be best placed to maximise its potential. There are a few other industries, I think, where time is money can be more accurate. So I'd be interested, if there is a, you know, opposing view to that, what evaluation has been done to contradict the view that that is where the skills base is and where it has then the most potential for growth. All these things, I mean, the comments I've shared, it's not just about a list of complaints about support for the sector, but I hope some insights of the people who work in film and TV and who are actually passionate about its success, and I hope that the government will take them in that spirit. We've heard briefly about the issue of the BBC, Presiding Officer, and I'll just finish with a comment on that. I am worried, as Claire Baker said, that the BBC could be caught between two governments, one with an agenda to belittle it and another with a desire to break it up. And I think future success would be best served by making more programming in Scotland for network television rather than seeking to divide limited resources. Scottish tech content is very, very important, but it shouldn't be seen as the sole contribution of the BBC to Scottish life. In an online age, I'm just not convinced that talk of another channel is the way to go. But I can see you're keen to change the channel, Presiding Officer, so I shall desist.
Many
at that
thanks.
Point. Thank you.
Very tight for time now. John McAlpine, up to 4 minutes, to be followed by Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I hope I don't seem too modest when I say that it was myself who, as a committee member, who first suggested an inquiry into the creative industries, because as co-convener of the cross-party group in culture, it's a subject close to my heart, though of course the success of this report is down to every member of the committee, our witnesses, our clerks and SPICE, which I think has done a particularly good job in supporting us in this inquiry. I was very keen that the committee had an inquiry into the creative industries, and we decided to concentrate on the screen industries in the end, because I believe it's important that we recognise just what a vital sector it is to our economy. It's the same size and employs them, the same number of direct employees as oil and gas. The committee report, as has already been acknowledged by the convener, is testament to the Parliament's committee system and its ability to bring important matters to public and government attention and to give Scots a voice in their own Parliament to shape government policy and priorities. At the time of embarking on the inquiry, we had not anticipated the debate around the future of the film industry and what it would generate, and that emerged entirely as a result of the quality of the written and oral evidence we heard, and the efforts of two extremely impressive and formidable women who also happen to be leading film producers in Scotland, Arabella Page-Croft and Gillian Berry. And I'd like to pay tribute to their tenacity and the way they engaged with the committee. And I know that Arabella and Gillian will be disappointed that we still don't have a film studio, which was one of the key recommendations of the report. However, since the inquiry began, there have been a number of significant announcements, as has already been alluded to, in particular the two new funds announced in February, worth £3 million, the fund announced today, and in May, of course, the Scottish Government announced plans to form an expert group to assist the government and its agencies to better understand the film industries, and that was in direct response to the committee's recommendation. And others have talked about this, and I think it's worth re-emphasising that one of the key difficulties that was highlighted by the inquiry was the failure of Scottish Enterprise and Creative Scotland to work well together. The committee made a whole raft of recommendations, and since I only have 4 minutes, I'll want to quote from number seven, which refers to that joint working and says the separate and distinct remits of Scottish Enterprise and Creative Scotland act as a barrier to working cohesively to effectively support the film industry. And the committee recommends that the Scottish Government direct Scottish Enterprise and Creative Scotland to work in partnership to support the economic and cultural needs of the industry and reviews the agency's performance annually against specific criteria. Now, in response, the Scottish Government acknowledged that communication between the new two agencies need to improve, and it has put a number of workshops in place, as the Cabinet Secretary has already mentioned. In response to Gavin Brown's point, I actually decided to get my staff to call up Creative Scotland today to ask about the progress of the Memorandum of Understanding, and they were told that it was in the action plan and it was still being drafted. So I acknowledge the Scottish Government's role in prioritising the recommendations of the committee, and I think the Scottish Government have shown that they take this very seriously indeed, but I'm not convinced that the two agencies concerned have quite taken on board some of the inquiry's recommendations in the same way the Scottish Government. And I think the heads probably need knocked together, and I think it was quite clear from the evidence that we took in committee by some of those agencies that they just didn't get it, and I hope that pressure will continue to be put on them that they respond to the committee's report in the way that the government has, and we see a fair way forward. Thank you.
Now Colin Patrick Harwood to be followed by Lewis MacDonald.
Thanks very much, and I'd like to add my thanks to my fellow committee members, as well as to our clerks and support staff, and to the many, many witnesses who came and gave evidence either in person or in writing. I got a lot out of this inquiry. I broadened my understanding of the subject significantly, and I think the committee's made a substantial contribution to debate on this topic as well. I did have to endure a fair amount of wind-ups from my colleague Alison Johnson, who each week would receive her weighty papers for the devolution
committee looking at the Scotland Bill and tease me about the fact we were off to go and play games. But I'd also like to thank those from the video games industry who did bring some of their products, some of their creations to the Scottish Parliament so that we could get a bit of a hands-on experience of what they were doing, what they were creating and what they were contributing to that industry in Scotland. In the time available, just a few brief observations I'd like to make. That these are not all the same industry. We can put them under a heading of the creative industries, but the circumstances and the needs of TV and of film are very, very different from those of the video games industry. TV and film, by their nature, are rooted somewhere, and this is embodied very clearly in the debate about a studio and the sense of weariness that many of the witnesses clearly had after not just years, but decades of discussion about whether we can create such a space in Scotland as a place that can attract substantial productions. They have to be rooted in a place. The video games industry, much less so. The video games industry, not only by its technical nature, but by the attitude to life of many of the people who take part in it, is hypermobile. And if we want that to become a lasting and a growing part of the Scottish economy, we're going to have to find other ways of attracting it, other ways of keeping it, which are much more about the skills, about the networks of people, and about the attitude to life, the attitude of young people thinking that Scotland is a place where you can do this. Not thinking that we have to be the Seattle of Europe, but that Scotland is a place where you can do this on its own terms, not by aping or echoing or envying somewhere else and something else. So the things that we need to do to attract and to retain and to continue to grow the video games industry, I think, are going to be fundamentally different. I do share that sense of frustration that the TV and film industries, and I think following Christian Allard's comment, on retrospect, we should perhaps have broadened the scope to include radio as well, because many of those same technical, writing, creativity skills that are coming into the TV industry find their way in or find a first expression through radio as well. So we perhaps should have been a wee bit broader there. But the circumstances are so different. I share the frustrations about getting a studio, and if we could attract more productions on the scale of Game of Thrones or the other things that will come with the fulfilment of that space, I'll celebrate it just as much as I celebrate Rockstar Across the Road and everything that they've done. But my final comment, my final reflection, is that in all of these areas, we also need to celebrate the little, the informal, the small-scale self-starter creativity that doesn't necessarily want to be the next Game of Thrones or the next rock star, but is absolutely where those skills and those attitudes of creativity are going to be born and are going to be fostered in people's backrooms and bedrooms and coffee bars around the country, with people working off their own bat and working with their own creativity rather than thinking that big is the only way to be. Thank you very much.
Now call on Lewis MacDonald to be followed by George Adam.
Thank you very much. Scotland's contribution to film and television goes back to the very beginning, but the truth is that we have failed to maintain that early advantage. Ian Smith of the British Film Institute told the Economy Committee that 20 years ago, Scotland was the biggest production cluster outside the southeast of England. Now it is probably fourth or fifth. And it's surely no accident that Scotland's loss of competitive advantage coincided with the abolition of Scottish Screen, a public body with a specific remit for promoting opportunities in film and television. It is certainly not by chance that Northern Ireland has moved ahead of Scotland with its own screen agency and relatively greater public funding. Of course, Creative Scotland was set up to replace Scottish Screen, but as Janet Archer herself told the committee, it was set up in a way which made progress difficult. It struggled to attract private investment. It even struggled, as Gavin Brown said, to give a lead to other public bodies working in the same field. A lack of clarity about the relationship between Creative Scotland and the enterprise agencies came up again and again in evidence to the Economy Committee's inquiry. There has since been a major reorganisation of Creative Scotland, and the agency believes that it is now in a better place to negotiate and generate the relationships it needs across the public and private sectors. That optimism is welcome, but the failure to agree a memorandum of understanding on schedule is a concern. There is clearly now quite a lot of catching up to do, and that, of course, is the responsibility of ministers to deliver, as well as of the agencies themselves. There is a particular challenge for Creative Scotland to do more to support independent television production in Scotland. The agency conceded in the inquiry that its film and TV broadcast fund was too small to do much on the television side. Welcome but modest increases in funding are unlikely to change that in any fundamental way. The challenge then is to get the most out of other public sector agencies and funding sources in order to fill that funding gap. The committee's inquiry found that there seemed to be little flexibility available to Scottish enterprise here to support production companies because of its focus on account managing growth companies, but on the other hand that Highlands and Islands Enterprise could do more because of its remit for community development. There is surely a case here to look at how best to join up support from public bodies in skills as well as in production, and to find ways to replicate the effective support provided by HIE in other parts of Scotland. Perhaps most important to stimulating independent television production is the lead given by Ofcom and public service broadcasters in setting and meeting quotas for production out with London. This has helped, and enterprising companies like Tern Television in Aberdeen have been able to produce high-quality programming for different channels and across the wider UK network. As Claire Baker and others said, the time has come for the public service broadcasters to go beyond the interim approach of lift and shift and instead to deliver sustained long-term benefit for production companies with staff based here on a permanent basis. But it's important also, I think, that commissioners should be based here too, because those who commission programmes will always start with high-quality producers whose work they already know. As we've heard, of course...
The commissioning point is absolutely vital. Yes, I agree that we should be providing more independent production and production from Scotland for network, but we also need to have the commissioning, the decision-making here in Scotland, and that is the proposal we're putting forward for the BBC.
Lewis McDonald.
Well, I welcome the broad principle of that, and commissioning as well as producing programmes is of critical importance. I think if all parties can focus on what public service broadcasters can do for the creative industries in Scotland and for the Scottish economy, that was the right approach to take when we come to discuss the BBC going forward and other related matters. And if we do that, I believe we can make a positive difference to the Scottish economy at this critical time.
Many thanks. I now call on George Adam. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Although I'm not on the committee, I am only too aware of the impact of the creative industries has on our economy in terms of jobs, investment and being used as a promotional tool for the various parts of our nation. They are a valuable contributor to the economy. As Murdo Fraser, the committee convener, has already stated, the creative industries are worth around £5 billion and currently employ 68,600 people. But they also can influence how the world sees us internationally. I also welcome, there's been much said during the debate about the progress that's been made towards the establishment of a permanent film studio in Scotland. This need was articulated by many individuals from the film and TV industry the last time they addressed the Education and Culture Committee. The studio would make a vital difference to considering the newer way of broadcasting TV and film with the different platforms that are now available through online subscription channels and a digital platform as well. And Outlander, that's been talked about much today as an example, because in the UK it's actually broadcast by Amazon Prime at the moment. And having read a bit about Outlander, Presiding Officer, you know, it's a drama series based on the historic time travel series of novels of Diane Gabaldon, TV created by Ronald D. Moore of Battlestar Galactica and Star Trek fame. What's not to like about this? I know what I'll be watching this weekend, because as a fully certified film and TV geek, I can't wait to see this progress even further, because we live in exciting times as far as broadcasting are concerned, and there are these other opportunities within the industry as well. But although things with the studio are at a very early stage, Presiding Officer, I can see no better place for our national film studio than the great town of Paisley. The creative talent is there, Our geography is actually perfect for it, and it has the transport links both internationally and domestically for such a studio. But film and TV can influence the way the world looks at us, our towns and our communities. For once, again, I would like to use my own constituency as an example where movies and TV have influence. There was a movie made a number of years ago about the Stone of Destiny and Ian Hamilton, when a Paisley man incidentally as well, who reclaimed the Stone of Destiny in the 1950s. They filmed at the Paisley Abbey in Paisley, obviously in Paisley, which stood for the Westminster Cathedral. Now, this showed that we could use the historic buildings and infrastructure that we have in a town like Paisley for that, and that has led to many other TV and production companies coming to the town as well. BBC have ongoing various antique shows that travel the length and breadth of the country. One in particular was Flog It, which my wife was in. I'm actually sick of hearing about that show because it's broadcast throughout the world, and family members in other countries have been telling us constantly as if it just happened yesterday. It actually happened about 5 years ago. But that shows you the impact of even a television show like that. Like STV Productions, when we're talking about the way things are done differently in broadcasting now, STV Productions do another show like this for the BBC, Antique Road Trip, which has visited Paisley on numerous occasions because they see the history. They see what's available within the town as well. So, Presiding Officer, I would say I welcome the report, I welcome the hard work that's been done by many of my colleagues that are on that committee, but can I also say that we do live in exciting times, and I think it's now the time for Scotland to actually reassert itself as a broadcasting nation and film nation.
Thanks. Well, we now move to closing speeches, and I call on Gavin Brown. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Brown, please.
Presiding Officer, thank you. It's been a very interesting debate, and I have to say I particularly enjoyed the rather uplifting contribution we just heard from George Adam, a man who never disappoints, I have to say. In bringing the close to this debate, at least from this side of the chamber, I think I want to pick up on the points that I want the government to really focus upon and drive forward in the coming months, because it's not about activity, it's about action on the ground and making a real difference. I welcome the fact that the government agree there should be a review of the video game sector to be led by Creative Scotland. That was a conclusion of the committee. The government signed up to that, and I was pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary saying that it would begin shortly. If she has time in closing, if not, perhaps something written could be put forward. I'd be interested to know when that is going to begin and the rough timescale for it. Because of the nature of that industry, it is something that has to happen quickly. It's an industry that does change regularly, and the idea of a typical industry view that might take a year or two, I think, just wouldn't be appropriate for that particular kind of industry. Just to give you a notion on the sort of changes that happen in that industry, according to Scottish Government figures, in 2010, there were 200 employees within the industry. 2013, there were 1,000. So a five-fold increase over a three-year period. This is an industry that is going places, and I think with the right strategy, it could really go places. When that review happens, I would ask the government to keep an open mind on the results of the review, on their idea of a national strategy, because the committee suggested that a national strategy ought to happen for the industry. The government seemed a little, they didn't dismiss it, but they seemed a little lukewarm about the idea and certainly didn't commit to it in the written response that I was able to see. Once that review has taken place, I urge the government to revisit that and to pull together a national strategy. I know there is a digital leadership group, of which the video games industry is a part, but I just think, given the type of growth we've seen over the last couple of years, in my opinion anyway, it certainly merits a national strategy of its own. But let's see what the review turns out. Presiding Officer, just one point I want to throw in, I don't know whether it's true or not, but it's a statement that was made in the report and it appeared to go unchallenged. I'm hoping it's wrong. But the statement said, there is no strategy for growing the television sector in Creative Scotland's 10-year strategic plan. I don't know if that is true or not, but I'd like the Cabinet Secretary to respond to that. If that is true, clearly some change needs to happen there. It appeared to go unchallenged, but I may well be
in correcting that. I've talked about the memorandum of understanding. I won't say much more than that, just to say I think that is a priority, not just for its own sake, but actually because of the message and the signal it sends out to industry. If we can't get that right, we're not going to see the cultural changes that we need across the organisations who are responsible for it. And the other area I just would be interested to hear more on, we heard from the Cabinet Secretary about the £3 million worth of funding announced some 7 or 8 months ago. £2 million, I think, was a loan fund for production companies. £1 million was for the Screen Skills Scotland Fund. It would be interesting to know what sort of drawdown have we seen for the £3 million. Are we in a better place where actually that money is being put to good use, or do we still have some of the same challenges we had with the previous £2 million fund? Deputy President, the last thing I want to say is it is clearly for the committee members to decide their work programme going forward, but I would just put out a plea to them too to say that I hope, having done all this excellent work, having really pulled together, I think, a very good paper, I hope they do some kind of follow-up session, perhaps towards the end of the year or early next year, to get those same witnesses back to check on the progress that has happened so that we don't have a similar debate in a year's time or 2 years' time with the similar challenges we've heard of today. Thank you.
Many thanks. Now call on Anne McTaggart. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And closing for these benches today, we also welcome the number of recommendations that were made in the report, including leading the coordination of the industry, academia and public bodies to establish a national strategy which will deliver a sustainable Scottish games industry. And we also welcome the funding commitments made today in advance of today's debate. However, the findings made in the report that there is an apparent lack of ability of agencies to collaborate or work within the industry itself, which is rather concerning for many of our speakers today. And I quote from the report, "The separate and distinct remits of the Scottish Enterprise and Creative Scotland are acting as barriers to working cohesively to effectively support the film industry." Presiding Officer, this situation is so detrimental to Scotland's culture. As outlined in the report and in today's debate, it is vital a decision over a film and TV studio in Scotland is reached as soon as possible. Otherwise, the effects on our film and TV industries will be damaged. Together with the Scottish Government and its agencies and the film and TV industry, we can agree that this is a priority for growing the sector. And I don't think I could go any further, but as a Glasgow MSP, I would obviously believe that Glasgow would be best placed to accommodate it. Presiding Officer, Claire Baker and Gordon MacDonald mentioned within their speeches the Ofcom quotas for greater production and spend in Scotland by the public service broadcasters. They represent a huge opportunity to increase the skills and expertise within Scotland's independent TV industry. We welcome the call made by the committee upon the BBC and the Channel 4 to adopt this as a new approach to commissioning by the end of 2016, if not sooner. It is important to note that following the Smith Commission, we will have a consultative role for the first time in the charter renewal process, and it is vital that we all work and cross-party work constructively to get the best deal for our viewers in Scotland. The Scottish Labour Party is committed to calling for increased investment for BBC Scotland from within the licence fee settlement and for the retention of the quota systems for commissioning from nations and regions. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, there is no doubt that the creative industries bring valuable economic benefits to individuals, communities and the country as a whole. Scotland's cultural and creative activities are as relevant to our international reputation, our economic prosperity and the trade and investment agenda, as does direct business support and export promotion. However, it is vital that all the agencies in this industry should work together and collaboratively to achieve the greater results and the best results that we can for Scotland's people. And we're open to working together with the Scottish Government in providing a better support to meet the needs of individuals and companies within the sector.
Thanks so much. I now call on Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop. 6 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much, members, for the contributions. A number of areas I want to specifically address. Those I can't, I will follow up, and I am committed to return with updates to the committee, because I do think this is a moving feast. I think there will be developments. I think it's right for the committee to hold the government to account, and indeed to hold the agencies to account as well. Some of the areas, obviously, of key concern. The schedule is still under negotiation in terms of our the Film Leadership Group's discussions with the private sector developer. There were 5 bids for the private sector when the private sector tendering and request was put out. Only 3 were eligible. 2 were fully public sector funded approaches. We cannot provide 100% public sector funding in terms of support for the schedule. In terms of the film sector, one of the things that the independent producers, very briefly, yep.
Can I make it?
The Cabinet Secretary for taking intervention. It's quite a complicated picture to understand the film studio proposals. There is, in May, there was a proposal that was a private investor for Pentlands area. How does she see these type of activities fitting in with the idea of a government-supported studio?
Well, that was the exercise that was carried out was a call for a private sector proposal. I'm quite happy actually to write to the members contributing to the bid to give you an update of where we are and indeed the process to date. Those discussions with the private sector developer are continuing, but in terms of confidentiality, I can't necessarily give you the full details of who, where, when, etc. But we are on the case in terms of making sure we have that studio, because everybody's very, very clear that we need that infrastructure. We have got locations. King Arthur, for example, was getting filmed earlier this year. In terms of the productions are taking place. Outlander, in terms of the scale of production economic impact, I think is comparable in early years in relation to Game of Thrones. But in relation to the funds that we announced, the £3 million, £1 million of that is skills development. We'll be announcing very soon where that skills funding is going. The other was in relation to loans. They will also become more advantageous because of the UK tax changes, but also we were told, and that £2 million loan fund was precisely as a response to the producers that Joan McAlpine talked about coming to a meeting with myself and John Swinney, and that's one of the suggestions that came out of that. There has been some drawdown, but clearly it depends on the projects that are there, but we're moving, particularly with the tax changes, into a more, you know, an obvious area for use of that fund. And clearly in terms of the other aspect, a production fund itself, the £1.75 million announced today will also provide incentive that which might provide opportunities for people to draw down other areas, whether it's skills or indeed loans, because some of these financial packages can be quite complex from the industry's perspective. In terms of other areas, the point about sustainability in the screen sector is really, really important. And that's where I think we need to think very carefully about what we mean by public sector broadcasting. If we're going to have successful public service broadcasting in the future, it really is important that we have indigenous companies able to take the benefit from that. And in terms of the creative industries more generally, I want to pick up Patrick Harvey's point. They have the very, very micro. We have the importance of supporting the entrepreneurial startups. And we also see, particularly in the video games industries, where it is fast moving, that people move from company to company very, very quickly. It's why, in reticence in relation to strategy, one of the things that the video game sector said to me, if you spend time on a strategy, it will be out of date by the time it's written, because the sector is moving so quickly. So therefore, working with the sector in terms of the review of what's needed is really important, but acting on it and acting on it promptly is one of the key areas. And, Presiding Officer, I want to particularly focus on an area which hasn't been touched on, which will become increasingly important, and that's the digital single market and the importance perhaps of the committee itself in looking at this area and its implications. And one of the issues affecting creative industries and the wider sector will be the digital single market strategy. In May, Presiding Officer, I attended the EU Culture and Audiovisual Council in Brussels. I represented the UK during the policy debate on the EU Digital Single Market Strategy and the Audiovisual Media Services Directive. And it is very important that we ensure that Scottish creative industries' interests interests are represented in the EU's proposals on that in the coming months and years. And I will work with the UK Government to make sure that their consultation processes around the digital single market are inclusive of the creative industries. In terms of other areas that were touched on, I've mentioned the issues around games. In terms of television, the sustainability in particular, on film, the importance of having a different package of activity. But the underlying point, and I think it's very important that I do address this, is how Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise work together. It's clear from Lewis MacDonald's questions, this is not a new issue. Scottish Screen was originally proposed for merger with the Scottish Arts Council under the previous administration, but that does create challenges. But why is it when you have other sectors like life sciences that have to work, yes, with the private sector, but also with the health service and also with Scottish Enterprise, the solutions and the proposals can be brought to bear? And just because, and this is where I might challenge Patrick Harvey back, just because creative industries has a diversity in terms of the different areas doesn't mean that we shouldn't and can't have similar types of dedicated and focused support as other key sectors have. And I think that's the expectations that quite clearly comes through from the committee's report. It's what the expectations are from this government. And the Deputy First Minister and I are very clear to the two public agencies, Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise, that we expect them to provide services to the sector, not to each other. And that's why, in terms of what we will expect from them, it will be results in change of how they go about things, and certainly being informed by the workshops that have been taking place over the summer period with the sector itself. Please. But I am really excited for this sector. I think there are possibilities. I think perhaps a reflection from Drew Smith, there is cynicism, but there's also opportunity, and that's where I see this sector. I think the opportunities should hopefully in the near future outweigh that cynicism as we move forward.
Many thanks. I now call on Dennis Robertson to wind up the debate on behalf of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Mr Robertson, you have until 5 o'clock, which is exactly 6 minutes and 20 seconds.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and the clock is ticking. Presiding Officer, it gives me great pleasure to actually wind up this debate because I want to sort of focus on what the Cabinet Secretary said towards the end, and that is there's a degree of excitement, but there's also frustration. And I think throughout this debate, and certainly throughout the witnesses that we heard at committee, there was hope for the industry, there was excitement, there was ambition. You know, when I was listening to Patrick Harvey, I was thinking, my goodness, Patrick, you know, your energy you were actually within the debate was fantastic. And that was something that was represented within the committee when we were taking evidence. But at the same time, as Joe McAlpine said, and Joanne Lamont said, there was frustration, there was anger, there was disappointment. And I think when we look at where we are within this report, it was challenging. And we knew what the challenges were, well, maybe to some extent, because I certainly went into this one not actually knowing what the outcomes would be. Because did I understand the industry? Did I understand the complexities around it? Well, no, I did not. I certainly learned a lot during the taking evidence during the committee. And can I say that at this point, Presiding Officer, can I thank the clerks and the witnesses for the work that they put into this report? And when Murdo Fraser, you know, started off by perhaps quoting Gandhi, I'm not sure if he's being maybe just a little tongue-in-cheek and maybe a bit flippant sometimes, as Murdo can be, even as a convener. But I really think, you know, as a committee, we were set a task, and we set ourselves a task, not to build up the government and the success of, but it was to look in depth and analyse exactly where we are, and hopefully the direction we are going. There is no doubt, and I don't think anyone is shying away from the aspect that Creative Scotland and Scottish Enterprise have not been working together as collaboratively as they could have been. I am delighted to hear that workshops have been taking place. It is perhaps with some regret that we haven't come to some final outcome there. But I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary and certainly the Deputy First Minister, certainly when they were at committee, were in no doubt that they were looking towards both those public agencies working together for the good of and to the betterment of the industry as a whole. When we looked at taking this forward, we did look at film, TV and the video games. Three very distinctive, although, as Patrick Harvey rightly said, you could probably take film and television to some degree together. What is this, what's the stumbling point for us? Well, the film studio. And what is another stumbling point? Location of the film studio. But can I say to Lewis MacDonald, when he was talking about the success of Northern Ireland and the film studio and other film studios, and certainly in Wales, what he forgot to mention was state aid. And we were very clear in the committee that we acknowledged the problems of actually establishing the film studio, given the rules that were actually probably creating the barrier. And barrier was mentioned a few times during this evening's debate, presiding officer. But barriers shouldn't be an obstacle. Barriers, if you acknowledge them and you acknowledge they exist, should be an opportunity for change. And I think this is probably the direction we're going in. And I was taken with the fact that Christian Allard, inventive as he always is, started to talk up the North East and Dundee in particular for the location of a film studio. And then we heard, of course, from George Adam saying, no, it should be in Paisley. It just shows that comedy is still alive, presiding officer, perhaps within this industry in itself. But in saying that, Edinburgh is home to the fringe. However, Glasgow does make the point. And I think what we heard in evidence, and I'm certainly not going to preempt and prejudge the location of a film studio when it eventually comes, but I think John Lamont said, you know, if we can have the Commonwealth Games in Glasgow, why not? We have the infrastructure. I'm sure there'll be many other bids, many other bids. I was delighted when we looked at the TV industry that the Cabinet Secretary took the time to visit Aberdeen, and actually Lewis MacDonald mentioned Turn TV, and the Cabinet Secretary visited Turn TV in Aberdeen to see for herself the work that goes on within the independent sector. And I sincerely hope she came away and was impressed with the work that was certainly being produced by Turn TV. And I think this shows us that we do have the skill, the ambition, the talent here within Scotland. There's much to be done, and we've talked about commissioning, and we certainly need to see commissioning changing and the commissioning and production coming to Scotland. And I sincerely hope, with the public consultation that's out there, and certainly when we're looking at the programme for government, the opportunities that are before us, certainly looking at what we have in terms of a future within broadcasting, Scotland can certainly lead the way, and people of Scotland can actually take the opportunity to take the lead. Within the video and games, I was criticised actually during taking evidence to some extent that I hadn't participated in the gaming in itself. I always found that using certain technologies in gaming may be somewhat arduous and difficult, but maybe not impossible. But perhaps I should make a commitment to look at trying to ensure that I will commit myself to try and see if I can actually look, see my way around getting into some of the games that are on available to me, presiding officer. But Patrick Harford said that they came into the Parliament and they demonstrated what they have and where they are going. We have the talent, we have the ambition, we have the skill. It is, we have an amazing abundance of that. But, presiding officer, they do need that extra lift. They need the help. They need the help from Gateway Scotland. They need the help from the colleges. They need the help, the infrastructure, bringing it together. They cannot be left out there in limbo. Presiding officer, I think we will return to this subject. And I know that the EET looks forward to having an update from the Scottish Government at the end of the year, as we have asked them to do so. And I'm sure we will return to this debate in the Chamber. Presiding officer, thank you.
Thank you, Mr Robertson. That concludes the debate on economic impact of the film, TV and video games industries. We now move to decision time. There is one question to be put as a result of today's business. The question is motion number 14048 in the name of Murdo Fraser on the economic impact of the film, TV and video games industries be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time.